London is hushed, and all over the world, countless millions are waiting to take part in spirit in the last journey of His Majesty King George V, away from the crowds and turmoil of his capital, to rest with his ancestors in the peace of Windsor by the quiet Thames. Her Majesty the Queen takes her place in the glass coach with the King's sister, Queen Maud of Norway, the Princess Royal and the Duchess of York. His Majesty the King moves into his position behind the gun carriage. Then come his three brothers, and the procession moves slowly away. This last journey is the climax to all the moving, impressive scenes of the last few days. At Sandringham, it was the servants taking leave of the squire. During the lying in state, it has been the empire taking leave of its beloved father. But today, it is as if the great curtains have been thrown back, and the world takes leave of the man who was the symbol of all the might, majesty, and power of the British Commonwealth of Nations. For a few more hours, King George is surrounded by the utmost of pomp and ceremony that tradition and reverence can devise to the honor of its beloved dead. In the procession, there are five kings of Europe, the President of the French Republic, and diplomatic, naval, army, and air force representatives of every nation of the world. But of all this magnificent homage, the central focus is the gun carriage, drawn by a naval gun crew with a flag-draped coffin, the crown, the orb, the scepter, and the only flowers, a cross from Her Majesty the Queen. Was there ever so large and yet so silent a crowd? As the procession moves slowly along Piccadilly, across Hyde Park Corner, and into Hyde Park. In front of the gun carriage stretches a long, seemingly almost endless line of officers and men of the Royal Navy, the Army, the Air Force. At Marble Arch, the crowds are so great that at one time they completely block the road. But there's order and perfect silence as the royal procession passes out of the park. Then the route lies up Edgware Road, along Oxford and Cambridge Terrace, and so to Paddington Station, where the train is waiting to carry its royal burden to Windsor. Slowly it draws out, and the capital of the empire has paid its last tribute to a beloved sovereign. As the funeral train draws into Windsor Station, 100,000 people are waiting in the little town from which our royal family takes its name. Because of the enormous crowds in London, the train is over half an hour late. Again, the sad procession is formed, smaller than that which moved through the London streets, but still magnificently impressive, as the King of England walks behind his dead father, and the sorrowing Queen rides in the slow-moving carriage. And still the focal point of 100,000 eyes and 100,000 hearts, the coffin, with its glittering jewels and single cross of flowers. And so through the George IV gateway into the historic castle, first built by William the Conqueror, and still, after over 800 years, one of the chief homes of the English kings. And at last the journey is over, and the coffin is borne into St. George's Chapel, the place which of all others is most appropriate to the ideals King George represented in life. This chapel of the Knights of the Garter was built as a monument to the idea of brotherhood and leadership. And in these last 25 crowded, troubled, glorious years, if there is one thing that King George has taught, it is the art of the leader who is also a brother to his followers. As long as he lived, he was the guiding star of a great nation. When he died, the little children cried in the streets.
Now you blow through here, the music goes down and around, whoa, and it comes out.
Hey there, I'm Mike Gillett, your host, and this is When Radio Ruled, Episode 7, 1936. a look back at popular radio and American life in the year 1936.
The music goes down and around below, 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 diddly ho ho. Listen to that jazz come out. Then I push the other valve down. The music goes down and around, whoa, ho, 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 and it comes up here. Oh, I push the middle valve down. The music goes down and around, below, 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 diddly ho, ho, ho. Listen to that jazz come out. Then I push the other valve down. The music goes down and around, whoa, ho, 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 and it comes out here. Where? Here. Yeah.
That was Miss Gertrude Goldie of Patterson. And that concludes tonight's contest, ladies and gentlemen.
Washington, D.C., the Chamber of Commerce of the United States, says the present business boom is here to stay. Town Hall News shows great difference in the attitude of sales forces during depression and boom time. First, the sales attitude during the depression. The scene, a department store in 1932.
Sir, Mr. Judson.
Thank you, Miss Wilkes. Can I help you, sir?
Men's studs, please.
You want to price them?
No. I want to buy a collar button. I'm a customer.
Oh, a customer? Let me take a good look at you.
You don't know me, do you?
No, but it's been so long since I've seen a customer. I want to drink you in, every bit of you. Could I have your name?
Yes, it's Tudor Kelp. But all this fuss...
Oh, a customer is no fuss, Mr. Kelp. Do you mind if I show you off to the style?
Listen, mister, I'm shopping. This ain't a personal appearance.
Well, now, don't point it, Mr. Kelp. You don't know what you mean to the morale of this store. Miss Wilkes.
Yes?
Miss Crinkle.
Yes?
Mr. Bodkin.
Yes, Mr. Justin.
This is Mr. Kelp, a customer.
A customer?
Yes. You can touch him if you want to.
Oh, Mr. Kelp, can I have a lock of your hair?
Stand still, Mr. Kelp. I'll get a candid camera shot. Thanks.
Turn around, Mr. Kelp. I ain't seen a customer since I don't know when.
Well, ain't anyone been in this store lately?
Well, a woman did come in yesterday. She got wrapped up in her window shopping and went too far. She apologized, though, and left.
Well, I'm glad to meet all you folks, but all I need's a collar button.
A collar button, yes, sir. Mr. Bodkin.
Yes, Mr. Judson.
One collar button for Mr. Kell.
Yes, sir, right this way, Mr. Kell.
Oh, thank you.
Mind if we girls tag along? Lord, it's so long since I've seen a sale, I forget the technique.
Oh, I say, let's make a daisy chain. Take my hand, Mr. Kell.
Hey, wait a minute. You're sure this is a department store?
Oh, don't be bashful, silly. Come along.
Yes, Mr. Bodkin is waiting.
Now, this is our full line of collar buttons, Mr. Kell.
Oh, just anyone's okay.
Well, now, here, let me model one of the gold buttons for you.
No, I'll just slip this one in. That's all right.
Let me see, Mr. Kell. Tilt your chin. I think your Adam's apple shrieks for a Tecla pearl.
Well,
yes, exactly. With that hook-on bow tie you're wearing, a pearl button would do wonders for your neck.
Well, try this one, Mr. Kell.
Thanks. How's this?
That's it, definitely.
Yes, it sets off the celluloid in your collar, so.
Well, how much is it?
5 cents. Shall I send it insured?
No, I'll keep it on. Here's your nickel.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Kell. Cash, Miss Wilkes?
5 cents? Just right, thank you. We've certainly enjoyed having you, Mr. Kell.
Yeah, well, goodbye, all.
Goodbye, Mr. Kell.
What about a song, folks?
You bet.
He's a jolly good fellow. Kell's a jolly good fellow.
Ah, but how different today. With business booming, the sales forces have regained their frigid normalcy. The same customer returns to the same department store in 1936.
Cash, 5,000, Mr. Judson.
Credit, 10,000, Mr. Judson.
Oh, one at a time, girls. This is a $1 million day.
Oh, excuse me.
Yes, what is it? Speak up, man, I'm busy.
I'd like to get a collar button.
A collar button?
Why, you tramp.
A collar button.
Out you go.
Help!
Look, Cap, I'm awful hungry. How's for getting a couple of hamburgers, huh?
Yeah. How about some nice breasted chicken under glass?
No, I think I'll get a nice sirloin steak.
And what do you think you're going to use for money, slug?
Pardon me, but do you boys mean that you're broke?
Broke? Listen, mister. Tomorrow we start borrowing from the church mice. Get it?
Oh, that's terrible.
Good morning. I'd like to pay my income tax.
What did I tell you, Miss Livingston? Well, sir, this is the place. What's your name?
Johnny Green.
Occupation?
Orchestra leader.
Mm-hmm. Were you born in this country?
No, what orchestra leader was?
Now, Mr. Green, what was your gross income for 1935?
$325,842.09.
I see. And what was your net?
$12.
I suppose you took everything off that you're entitled to.
Everything but my shirt.
Oh.
And it won't be long now.
Did you have any bad investments last year, Mr. Green?
Yes, I bet on Max Fair to beat Joe Lewis.
Hmm. Any dependents?
Max Fair.
Oh, Miss Livingston, what does he owe us so far?
85 cents.
Oh, fine. I'll pay.
Just a minute now. Are you married? You know, you're allowed $2,500 for a wife.
If I had one, I'd sell.
I see.
Well, here's your 85 cents.
Oh, it's such a small amount. I'll toss you things. Double or nothing.
All right.
Head.
Tails, you lose.
Well, it isn't the first time the government took it on the chin. Goodbye.
So long.
Papa sent me out to mail a letter, so I thought I'd drop in.
Well, don't tell me Papa saw himself in the back of his blue serge suit and he's sending himself fan mail.
No, Papa's writing our congressman. He's worried about conditions.
You mean your father resents the general upswing in business?
I'll say it's costing him money.
Well, how can the upswing cost him? How is that?
Well, Papa's a plumber, mm-hmm. and when he didn't work during the Depression, he only lost $40 a week.
So?
So, now since the plumber's got a raise, Papa's losing $48, and those extra $8 are not to be sneezed at.
No, not unless they've got pepper on them, no.
If things get any better, Papa will go out of his mind.
Well, what's two steps in his life? Can't Papa get in on the boom?
He's thinking about selling fruit knives to the big corporations.
What'll General Motors and Western Electric do with fruit knives?
Papa says they can use them to cut melons.
Well, it's... It's really wonderful that the dividends the big companies are paying. You know, if some of the firms keep giving away money, the first thing you know, the stockholders will get the business.
Well, it wouldn't be the first time.
No, a stockholder can never tell when he's getting the business.
You know, I heard the snow was so deep up there around 159th Street that some boys made a snowman on the sidewalk there, and one of the put a broom in the snowman's hand, and one of those WPA executives came along and handed the snowman a check yesterday afternoon. He thought he was working on a project up there, just a little confused.
In 1936, economic recovery remained the number one concern of the USA. Things had stabilized since the dark early days of the Depression, but America still had a long way to go before the economy was healthy. Things weren't getting all that better, but they weren't getting worse either.
Waitress.
Yes, sir?
Give me a check, will you, please?
Okay. Orange juice and two cups of coffee. 35 cents.
All right. Keep the change.
Thank you, sir.
Adam and Eve on a ramp.
Unemployment had dropped to 16.9%, down from the high of 25% in 1933. But lots of folks were still struggling. Those that had jobs worked an average 40-hour work week for an average annual wage of $1,713.
Major, may I present a few quick facts?
Go right along, Dan.
There are certain things you get in any one of the famous four cars, Plymouth, Dodge, DeSoto, Chrysler. All four have safety steel bodies. You ride surrounded by steel. Yes, even the floors are steel. All four have genuine equalized pressure hydraulic brakes. So when you say stop, she stops. These two things alone mean safety for the American family. All four have floating power. The engine is so balanced and cushioned that you have to step on the accelerator before you're sure it's running. All four have new scientific distribution of weight, an amazing advance in riding comfort pioneered by Chrysler Corporation. And remember, only in the famous four cars, Plymouth, Dodge, DeSoto, and Chrysler, do you get all these engineering features that make for safety, comfort, and economy. Plymouth starts at $510 list price in Detroit, and it is the biggest, roomiest car in the lowest price range. The dependable, money-saving Dodge starts at $640. The beautiful, smart DeSoto is priced as low as $695. And you can even get a luxurious Chrysler for as little as $760. Finally, remember that you can own any of these cars on easy time payments through Commercial Credit Company Time Payment Service.
The average cost of a new house was $3,925. If you wanted to rent that average house, it would cost you $24 a month. Gas was 10 cents a gallon. A loaf of bread was 8 cents. A pound of hamburger cost 12 cents. Campbell's soup, 4 cans for 25 cents. First class stamp was 3 cents. And a lady's swimming costume cost $6.95.
I know that something certainly should be done about the designs of the bathing suits the girls have been wearing the last couple of summers. Some of the bathing suits they wore last year, somebody should design something. You saw a fellow walking along Coney Island with a girl, you didn't know whether he had an 8 weeks tan or whether he was blushing all over. It was very confusing.
1936 was an election year, and the election would be a referendum on the economy and Franklin Roosevelt's New Deal.
That the voters will ever remember what the Hoover administration did to them, and never forget what the Roosevelt administration has done for them.
Was the economy getting better in 1936 because of, or in spite of, FDR's policies?
For the taxpayers, let them kick in.
The taxpayers against them. All their lives, the taxpayers kicking for this and kicking for that. In fact, they're kicking until they kick off, and after they kick off, they're still in the hole.
Nobody knew for sure if the New Deal programs were working. They did know that the government was spending a lot of money and raising taxes on businesses and the rich to supply that money.
Before we get started, what is ABC, the ABC Quartet? What does ABC stand for?
It stands for All Brass City.
Oh, All Brass City. I thought it might have been another government project out that I didn't understand about.
The first Gallup poll happened in 1935. That poll set out to measure if the country was satisfied with Roosevelt's relief and recovery efforts. The poll found that the country wasn't satisfied. 60% believed the government was spending too much money, 31% thought it was the right amount of spending, and 9% thought that FDR should spend more. And nobody liked the taxes and fees that were used to fund the government programs.
And over a broad and endless highway of unredeemed pledges, broken promises, and forgotten principles come the heartless, greedy forces of plutocracy, privilege, and plunder, which neither slumber nor sleep, and insult our intelligence, challenge our sanity, and outrage our sensibility by urging us to adopt again the philosophy of Hooverism, the inferno of disaster, the horror of horrors, the abomination of desolation spoken of by the prophet Daniel. But what has the Roosevelt administration done? In Holy Writ, the creation of the universe, including everything from the tiniest grain of sand to the most stupendous star, is described in the sublime and simple language. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The vastness of the accomplishments of the Roosevelt administration make their adequate description impossible, and the emulation of this divine example of brevity indispensable. Therefore, in a word, under this administration, the value of the stocks in corporations held by millions of American voters have increased $31 billion. If this stupendous sum were equally divided among all the people, it would mean more than $237 for every man, woman, and child beneath the American flag. By what kind of arithmetic will the Liberty League demonstrate that this achievement has ruined the country?
Nobody was sure if Roosevelt was popular enough to win re-election. The Gallup election tracking poll was predicting that Roosevelt would win re-election comfortably.
Our president we have now, Theodore Delano Roosevelt, will be our next president. You can bet on that.
Well, that's fine. I'm glad to. And I don't have to ask you, of course, who's going to be the next heavyweight champion.
Well, now, I wouldn't be too certain about that.
Oh, yes, we know. That's no secret. Well, thank you. Oh, pardon me.
I'll say, though, that I'm quite sure that Joe Louis.
And I? Well, that doesn't really count. I don't think you need the crystal to see that.
The Literary Digest poll disagreed. They'd been in the presidential polling business for far longer than Gallup, and had successfully predicted the last five presidential elections. The Literary Digest was predicting a landslide victory for Alf Landon. Landon would win the popular vote 57.1% to 42.9% and secure a dominating 370 Electoral College votes, according to the Literary Digest.
And Republicans are spending a lot of money broadcasting their campaign speeches.
Yes?
Well, we have our own radio station, TEX. Why not let them go on together?
Together? But they're opposition parties.
That's all right.
Well, how would a thing like that work out?
We'll try it. You take one side and I'll represent the other. Here, I've got two campaign cards in this hat. One has the picture of the Democratic donkey on it. The other, the picture of the Republican elephant.
Okay, I'll pick first.
Yeah.
Oh, boy, I got the picture of the donkey.
You're looking in the mirror. The picture's on the other side.
Oh. I see. Yeah. I've got the Republican elephant.
All right. Now, you're a Republican, and I'm a Democrat, and we'll both broadcast the campaign speech over the same microphone at the same time. You start it.
Okay. Fellow citizens, I come to you on behalf of the Republican...
Democratic.
...party. If you'll vote for our candidate, whom you all know is the best man, Mr...
Roosevelt?
Landon, we will assure you high tariffs.
Low tariffs.
High.
Low.
High.
Low. High, low, everybody. This is Rudy Valley, Mr. Connecticut.
We'll do away with unemployment, build better roads, lower taxes.
Here too.
And reduce the national deficit, which is $22
billion. $21,999,811,212.11.
And to you veterans, we say, buddy, can you deny that we pushed through the bonus bill? Buddy, can you say we were unfair? Buddy, can you find a better man to vote for? Buddy,
can you spare a dime?
And in conclusion, I say there is one person who has the following of all men.
Yes.
Whose every action thrills.
Yes.
Someone all men would follow in every movement.
Yes.
And that person is none other than...
Gene Harlow.
Alf Landon was governor of Kansas and very popular with Republicans. Landon had been an enthusiastic supporter of Teddy Roosevelt, which endeared him to the progressive wing of the Republican Party. And his success as a governor during hard times won him the respect of the Hoover wing of the party.
During this campaign, reached its apotheosis in Chicago, where Governor Landon and Mrs. Simpson shared the front pages of several newspapers, with Mr. Roosevelt only appearing occasionally very far inside. So that one of my friends suggested that probably many voters would like Mrs. Simpson's name in on the ballot.
Landon supported the intent of the New Deal, but he attacked it as unfocused and wasteful. He promised more efficient management of the economy.
The danger to America in such a ghastly hoax is that when the people have been fooled by the cry of wolf, wolf, when there is no wolf, they are apt to think that every leader is just another foolish shepherd boy and every emergency is unreal. We Americans like straight shooters. We don't need to be fooled or duped into making sacrifices for our country. In the heart of every American lives the spirit of Decatur's famous toast, our country. In her intercourse with foreign nations, may she always be right, but our country, right or wrong.
FDR was campaigning with the belief that the election would be close. His first term started out with a whole bushel basket of New Deal legislation, but that had stalled when the court struck some of it down. He didn't know if the American people still believed in him.
I'm going to tell you the story of our fight to beat down the depression and win recovery. And where I stand, and from where I stand, it looks as if the game was pretty well in the bag. I am convinced that when government finance or any other kind of finance is honest, and when all the cards are on the table, there is no higher mathematics about it. It's just plain scoreboard arithmetic. Now, when the present management of your team took charge in 1933, the national scoreboard looked pretty bad. In fact, it looked so much like a shutout for the team that you voted a change in management in order to give... in order to give the country a chance to win the game. And today we are winning it.
As it turned out, Roosevelt didn't need to worry. 46 states went overwhelmingly for FDR. The popular vote was 27 million to 16 million. The electoral vote was an embarrassing 523-8. Landon only won two states, Maine and Vermont.
Where are you from? Well, Ed, believe it or not, I was born in Vermont and raised in Maine.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
Is that a fact?
That's true, absolutely true.
You were born in Vermont and raised in Maine? How old were you before you came to this country the first time? Well, I only am.
The Democrats also picked up five seats in the Senate, increasing an already lopsided majority.
Baltimore, Maryland. Governor Landon returns to Baltimore to fulfill campaign promise and eat some good Maryland oysters. Town Hall News shows Governor Landon ordering oysters.
Here are your oysters, Governor.
How did you know how many I want?
The Literary Digest said you were going to eat six.
I'll make them wrong again. Bring me a dozen.
If a fella like Landon can shake Roosevelt's hand and say, I'm with you, Franklin, I bow. His example, let's match it and bury the hatchet.
Yes!
Let's all be Americans now.
With war clouds again piling up in ominous thunderheads on the European horizon, with a dozen war machines in gear and ready to go at the drop of a hat, we bring you a man who knows perhaps better than any other the story behind the story and the headlines of despair that reach us out of Europe these days. He is John Gunther, one of the world's ablest newspaper men. For many years, foreign correspondent of the Chicago Daily News, author of the current bestseller, Inside Europe. He knows the men behind the news, the captains and the kings, the ministers and the dictators, the cast of characters in the drama of diplomacy and death. Mr. John Gunther, author of Inside Europe. As many of you know, Mr. Gunther's book is chiefly concerned with personality, the men in power, or those seeking power in Europe. What most impressed you about these men, Mr. Gunther? As a group, I mean.
If any general remark is possible, Mr. Valley, it's this somewhat unstartling one. They are all human beings. Behind the headlines are policies, and behind the policies are men. These men, even the sternest of the dictators, have colds in the head just like the rest of us. They have to eat and drink. They have, most of them, friends, families, hobbies, secret ambitions, private sorrows. And their early careers, before they reached international eminence, almost always were surprising.
For instance,
perhaps you can tell me what great modern minister of finance once wrote songs for musical comedies.
No, I'm afraid I can't.
It was none other than Dr. Schacht, the juggler of the German Reichsbank. Another finance minister with a whimsical sideline is Mr. Neville Chamberlain, Britain's Chancellor of the Exchequer. Mr. Chamberlain loves birds as well as budgets. During a desperately serious financial crisis a few years ago, he wrote a letter to the Times announcing that he had just seen a bird known as a gray water wagtail in a London park.
That ended the crisis, I suppose.
It probably helped.
Aggression and bloodshed dominated the international news in 1936. From Asia, Africa, and Europe came the drums of war.
To get back to the early careers of the great and the near great, I suppose everyone knows that Maxim Litvinov, the Russian foreign minister, worked for years as a clerk in a publishing house in London. He met Lenin for the first time in, of all places, the reading room of the British Museum. Then there is Señor Largo Caballero, the Spanish prime minister. He was a house painter by trade.
Adolf Hitler was once a house painter too, wasn't he?
Yes, I believe so. But he probably isn't exactly proud of that. He wanted to be a serious artist at one time, but he was refused admission to an art academy in Vienna before the war. Signor Mussolini, as you know, used to be a newspaper man himself after he got tired of teaching school for $10 a month. Joseph Stalin, on the other hand, once studied for the priesthood.
What would you say are the outstanding differences between Hitler, Stalin, and Mussolini, Mr. Gunther?
Once I wrote that people worshipped Hitler, feared Mussolini, and respected Stalin. Or you could put it that Hitler rules by emotion. He is a sort of prophet. That Mussolini rules by intellect. Whether you like him or not, he is an extremely intelligent man. And that Stalin rules by power of will and character.
What do you think of Blum, the French prime minister?
I think he is one of the most courageous men ever to hold office anywhere. I hope he lasts.
And do you think all these so very human and charming gentlemen will be able to keep the peace, Mr. Gunther? More directly, do you think a general European war will start in 1937?
Mr. Valley, wars are catastrophes. Unlike typhoons or hurricanes, they are made by men, not by nature. But like typhoons and hurricanes, their arrival is almost unpredictable. It seems to me that no power, not even the fascist powers, want war at the present time. A war, if it comes, will be the result of some disastrous accident.
The USA wanted nothing to do with the troubles on the other side of both oceans. So Congress voted for, and FDR signed, a Second Neutrality Act, using threats of trade disruption and economic sanctions for other countries if they misbehaved. The hope was that by using our economic might, we wouldn't have to use military might later on. Not that the country had any taste for war, or even the ability to intervene overseas against Germany and Italy.
And you know, my friends, honestly, we have so much. We have so much to be thankful for this Christmas. When you read the newspapers every day, and you watch the newsreels, and you learn of these dictators in foreign lands working feverishly day and night, getting ready to pour millions of sons of mothers into war, honestly, we ought to go down on our knees every night and thank God that we are Americans, living in America, a land of the free, where Santa Claus comes every single day in the year.
On March 7, Hitler publicly broke the Versailles Treaty, by reoccupying the demilitarized Rhineland. Hitler had secretly broken the treaty the previous year by building up his armed forces 3 times larger than allowed by the treaty. The rest of the world did nothing about either violation.
What do you think will be the eventual outcome in Spain?
My feeling, Mr. Valley, is that the loyalists still have a fair chance to win. It all depends on how many German and Italian troops come to the aid of the rebel chieftain, General Franco.
If there is hope for peace in Europe, in what direction does it seem to lie?
I think, Mr. Valley, it lies in cooperation among the great democracies, America included.
In 1936, Italy completed their conquest of Ethiopia. On May 1st, Ethiopia's emperor, Haile Selassie, fled the country and turned to the League of Nations for justice. Outraged, the League of Nations condemned Italy and imposed economic sanctions, which their countries then completely ignored. It was business as usual. Italy was not punished. Mussolini began to crow about the new Roman Empire.
The Duce has told them that the war is over. And now they will go back to their homes, and they will realize that in 7 months, Italy has accomplished one of the greatest military feats known in history. You hear now the band in the square playing, and the people are still calling him, and the balcony is still lighted, and he will appear again. Yes, he has just appeared at this moment, standing on the balcony, this lonely figure of a man who has led 44 million to this colossal victory in spite of sanctions, in spite of the hostility of the world.
Germany and Italy started to work closer together, signing a friendship pact and a military pact, naming themselves the Axis. Japan would become a future member. Japanese aggression was also alive and well, citing the need for a Greater Asia co-prosperity sphere. Japan increased her involvement in China to all-out war and gained control of more and more of that vast country, setting up a puppet state in northern China. 1936 was the year the Axis powers intervened in the Spanish Civil War, turning the tide for the rebels and cynically using the war to test and refine their latest death machines, especially airplanes.
The 3 most impressive words I've ever heard in my life were the words uttered by our president on the screen and on the radio when he said, "I hate war." And inspired by these words, I'd like to repeat a song which I introduced last year. The dogs of war are growling, once more the papers say, and battle clouds are starting to appear. But if they try to drag us in, we'll say, please go away. We're minding our own business over here. If they feel like a war on some foreign shore, let them keep it over there. If some fools want to fight and think might makes right, let them keep it over there. From coast to coast you'll hear a million mothers pray, whatever happens, please don't send my boy away. We're for you, Uncle Sam, but stay out of that jam. Let them keep it over there. If they feel like a war, fight and think might makes right, let them keep it over there. From coast to coast you'll hear a million doughboys cheer, our job is to protect our loved ones over here. With an ocean between, let us keep our hands clean, let them keep it over there.
In 1936, as Germany and Italy used armies and threats to change the balance of power, France sat by helplessly, and Britain was distracted by a royal scandal second to none. King Edward wanted to marry his divorced American lover, Wallace Simpson. The church opposed it. The House of Commons opposed it. The House of Lords opposed it. The Commonwealth countries opposed it. The British people opposed it. The king stubbornly insisted.
A special bulletin from the Press Radio Bureau. Friends of the royal family informed the United Press tonight that Queen Mary now feels that it is for the best interest of the empire that Edward should abdicate. She reached this conclusion, it is said, after a violent quarrel with the king yesterday, in which she pleaded with him for the sake of the empire to give up Mrs. Simpson. The king sharply refused. Persons close to the court described the meeting as a very sad one. Queen Mary was in tears, and the king, who had had little sleep recently, was pale, tired, and angry. After the interview, Queen Mary was described as showing symptoms of a nervous breakdown. One friend described her condition in these words: Queen Mary has cried herself out. Now she seems to be in a trance, hardly able to realize that all she and King George worked for, all the popularity of the royal family, which they had devoted their lives to fostering, is now tumbling down. Her distress is extreme. Another report tonight is that the Duke of York, who had recently informed King Edward that his health would not permit him to take over the throne, has made up his mind that this is practically inevitable, although he still hopes that Edward will yield to the pleading of the royal family and give up Mrs. Simpson. However, it is unlikely that anything really definite about the king's attitude will be known until tomorrow, when Prime Minister Stanley Baldwin addresses the House of Commons. Parliament has been called to meet at 2:45 o'clock tomorrow afternoon, London time, 9:45 a.m., New York time. From London, the Daily Mirror, a London newspaper, prints an editorial tonight saying that the opposition of the British dominions to the marriage of King Edward and Mrs. Simpson has been caused by what this newspaper calls the newspaper hooligans of the United States. It goes on to say that America's biggest export for the past 6 months has been venomous gossip and twisted headlines based on rumor, and that public opinion has not yet really crystallized in Britain, as the people's enlightenment has only just begun. The London Mirror also says, quote, "The Mirror favors the king's marrying Wally if he chooses. Every sensible man and woman in Britain today holds the view that anything which makes our monarch happy is good for him and good for the country. The king wants to marry Mrs. Simpson, and the people of Great Britain want his request granted, without diplomatic pressure. But it is easy to understand the nervousness of the Dominion premiers. What would our attitude be if our minds had been warped and numbed by a gangster press, intent only with providing boys with sensations of bellow above the din of traffic in the streets of New York and Chicago," unquote. The London Daily Mirror for several days has been urging the cabinet that they make public all the facts concerning the king. This bulletin was from the Press Radio Bureau. Meanwhile, Columbia will continue to interrupt all scheduled programs wherever necessary in order to keep its public abreast of the latest developments in the British crisis.
Yeah. Now let me be your stuttering, if you be my bro. Now we can dance together all about the road. Let me be your dishpan, if you be my little oldie. Now we can eat together anytime we want. Now let me be your clothespin, if you be my pulling line. We can hang out together most any old time. Now let me be your whistler, if you be my whistler dance. For that's the coldest love song to a chain romance.
You flew all the way from California, and then, of course, you fly back.
I think so.
It'd be a fine thing if the prize stopped in the middle, wouldn't it? It'd be a fine thing.
Well, those planes, it's certainly wonderful, the service you can get to California. Now, how long did it take you to come?
It took just 18 hours.
18 hours. Yes. We were out there last summer, and I saw some of those big TWA planes there. They've got everything on them but an 18-hole golf course. I guess their planes will have those on them shortly. You certainly can fly around the country, though. We had, just to give you an idea, you've heard of the Pan-American Clipper, haven't you?
Yes.
Well, some people in Honolulu knew that we were going away next week and sent Portland a little bunch of Hawaiian flowers, sent from Honolulu Monday afternoon, and they were here this morning. Wonderful, isn't it?
It is.
From from Hawaii to New York City in practically 2 days. But I don't want to take up your time discussing aeronautics, if that's the word. It'll have to do for now.
America was also making big improvements in aviation technology. In 1936, Pan Am introduced its China Clipper passenger service from San Francisco to Honolulu and other Pacific islands. This was an incredibly complex undertaking. There were no planes that could fly that distance. The longest leg was from San Francisco to Honolulu, over 2,000 miles. So Pan Am had a new plane designed and built, the Martin M-130. This would be one of the biggest planes built to date. Four engines and a wingspan of 130 feet. There were few airports at that time that could accommodate a plane that big. So the Martin M-130 was a flying boat, landing on and taking off from water. On April 18, 1936, Pan Am began regular passenger service from San Francisco to Honolulu, to Wake Island, and then to Manila. A ticket from San Francisco to Manila cost $799. The route would soon be extended to add a Manila to Hong Kong leg, bringing truth to the name China Clipper.
A little domestic drama between the scenes. We're in the modern apartment of Jim and Elsie. They are dressing to go out in the evening. Elsie is putting on her stockings and pop, another run. Just listen to Jim.
What, again? Oh, say, I'll bet I could cut down on those stocking runs.
Oh, yeah? Well, put your mammoth brain to work.
Say, it never stops working. I'm full of dope on the question right now.
Well, spill it, big boy, but make it snappy.
Okay, here's the first tidbit. You know, I heard Sis spilling a mouthful about runs the other day.
Oh, I bet she was crabbing.
That's why you're balmy, baby. She's got the runs problem licked. Come on, Sis, says I. Tell a guy how you do it. Elsie's runs are driving me nuts. And she says nothing to it. Hardly a run have I had since I switched to Lux.
Say, that's an idea.
Oh, I'll say so, cupcake. And here's another.
Another what?
Another juicy bit. Heard my secretary spill this one on the phone.
I suppose her stockings never pop a run.
Right the first time. And you know why? She uses Lux. L-U-X.
Well, I'm a smart girl, too. Here's where I switched to Lux.
Outstanding hit among passengers aboard the Queen Mary tonight is Love is Like a Cigarette. So reads a radiogram just received from Henry Hall and his orchestra. And America likes this English tune, too, and ranks it 10th in popularity this week.
Just like
like a cigarette. Love seemed to fade away and leave behind ashes of regret. Then with a flip of your fingertip, it was easy for you to forget. For love is like a cigarette.
In medical news of 1936, condoms became legal in the United States for the first time. The first artificial heart was invented, a device that worked from outside the body to filter and pump blood. One of the inventors was the legendary aviator Charles Lindbergh. Every day it seemed something miraculous was happening in the care of the sick and disabled.
We present now one who is in many respects the most remarkable woman of our time. Miss Helen Keller, deprived of sight, speech, and hearing since early babyhood, her life has been a series of dramatic triumphs over seemingly insurmountable obstacles. She has learned to talk, a superhuman achievement for a person who can neither see nor hear. She has graduated from the regular course of Radcliffe College, cum laude. She has raised more than $1 million to finance the American Foundation for the Blind, bringing joy and happiness to countless thousands. Miss Keller's lifelong companion and teacher, Ann Sullivan Macy, had planned to be here also tonight, but illness keeps her at home. We send her our best wishes for a speedy recovery. In her place, Miss Keller's secretary, Miss Polly Thompson, will assist us. Before I introduce Miss Keller herself, Miss Thompson will tell us something about Helen's early years. Miss Thompson, how could Mrs. Macy begin to communicate with Helen as a child?
That beginning, Mr. Valley, was one of the most remarkable things in the history of education. You have seen deaf and dumb people talk to each other with their fingers?
Yes, but Helen was blind. She couldn't see the manual alphabet. And, of course, she couldn't hear it.
That's true. So teacher taught her to feel the alphabet. She placed Helen's doll in one of her hands. Then she made the signs of the letters D-O-L-L. Over and over again, with her fingers resting on the inside of Helen's other hand.
And Helen learned what those signs meant?
She soon learned that when she made those same signs in teacher's hand, she got her doll. And she learned other words the same way, particularly things she liked to eat. But even so, Helen didn't realize yet that everything has a name.
That was the next step?
Yes. Helen had already learned that when she formed the signs for W-A-T-E-R, she got a cup of water to drink. But she didn't know which was cup and which was water until one day, out in the yard, teacher held her hand under the water from the pump and spelled W-A-T-E-R into the other hand. Then suddenly it dawned on Helen that everything has a name, and she insisted on learning the name of everything she touched, all the way back to the house.
And then?
From then on, teacher says, Helen's education was very much the same as any child's, only she learned through her hand instead of through her eyes and ears.
And when did she learn to talk?
She declared her intention to learn to talk when she was 11, only 3 years after her education had begun. Teacher explained how impossible this was, but Helen went right ahead and learned, though it took her many years.
Miss Keller has a particular purpose in talking to the radio audience tonight, I believe.
Yes. The Better Vision Institute, a foundation in which she is very much interested, is cooperating with eyesight specialists for a national effort along educational lines. Miss Keller is anxious that everyone should know about Save Your Vision Week and the work of the Institute.
And we are very happy, Miss Thompson, to be of any assistance. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we ask the courtesy of your very close attention as we present a very great lady, Miss Helen Keller. Miss Keller, I shall ask you a few questions, and Miss Thompson will transmit them to you. Tell me, Miss Keller, I know you will realize the question isn't as impertinent as it may sound. Are you happy?
Yes, I'm happy. Happiness comes from within. I have courage and faith. I am happy.
If you could have one wish granted, what would it be?
I want to wish for light in every eye and in every mind.
Probably more people are listening to your voice now, Miss Keller, than ever before. Is there anything you wish to say to them?
Yes. I hope that everyone listening today will help the Black Prison Institute in its effort to conserve my state. Be a friend to those who will never see the light of day. Be good to them always. There is no lovelier way to thank God for your sake than by giving a helping hand to someone in the dark.
Miss Keller, we think you are one of the finest, grandest women in the world. We thank you for appearing on our broadcast.
Thank you, Mr. Valley. Good night.
Good night.
In the popular culture of 1936, the novel Gone with the Wind was published, became an immediate bestseller. Billboard magazine published its very first pop music hit parade. And Felix the Cat, the extremely popular silent animated cartoon character, made his debut in talking movies.
What's your name?
I'm Felix the Cat.
My boy, for your bravery in protecting your king, I crown thee Prince Felix.
We're not afraid, are we?
Not old King Cole.
Not Felix the Cat.
Papa sent me out to get the paper. He's reading about those quadruplets over in Passaic.
Oh, quadruplets are getting pretty common these days. There are 36.
That's what Papa says.
Papa says what?
Papa says if you hear a man yelling four, you don't know whether he's playing golf or his wife just had quadruplets.
You know, I hear that over in Jersey now, the baby doctors are traveling around in gangs, just in case.
Papa's ready. He's working on a quadruplet baby carriage. It has a trailer.
Gee, that's a swell idea. A baby carriage with a trailer, huh? How does he account for the epidemic of quads?
He says it's just the stork trying to show he can fly as many people as the Hindenburg.
Well...
Pan Am had begun flying passenger service over the Pacific, but their application for the license to fly passengers across the Atlantic was held up by international bureaucratic red tape. As a result, passenger air service across the Atlantic was dominated by German companies, using their fleet of Zeppelin airships. The Hindenburg Zeppelin was the first airliner of any kind to offer regularly scheduled passenger service from Europe to North America. It was a pivotal point in aviation history. Airplanes and Zeppelins, two very different technologies, both developed during World War I, being used to do the same thing, move people from point A to point B faster and safer than previously possible. One would eventually dominate, that much was for sure, but which one was anybody's guess? They both had advantages. Zeppelins had the successful track record. Germany's Graf Zeppelin had already flown around the world and over the North Pole. For the last 5 years, the Graf Zeppelin had flown regular passenger service from Germany to South America. Pan Am's China Clipper airplane was twice as fast as a Zeppelin, with a cruising speed of 188 miles per hour compared to the Hindenburg's cruising speed of 74 miles per hour. The Hindenburg was a lot bigger, over 800 feet long, compared to the just over 90 feet for the Clipper. The Hindenburg could carry more passengers, a capacity of 50 passengers along with the crew. The China Clipper was restricted by weight and fuel considerations. While it could carry as many as 32 passengers, the longest leg of the trip, San Francisco to Honolulu, it could only carry 8 to 12 passengers depending on how much the passengers weighed. The Hindenburg was a lot like the luxurious ocean-going cruise ships they were also competing with. The China Clipper was a bumpy, noisy ride that could get really rough if the weather was acting up.
You're very fortunate at this particular time to be here. Have you seen the Queen Marie?
Uh-huh.
You can't tell what will turn up for sightseer coming to New York. It's sort of a bag of tell game. This week, the Queen Marie is here. A few weeks ago, the Hindenburg was here. Last week, Mr. Zionchek was here. You never can tell. You come here to see things. Well,
A passenger named Webb Miller was on the maiden voyage of the Hindenburg, and he wrote down a detailed description of the experience. Quote, "After we passed through the customs and the passport control and were warned against carrying matches aboard, we mounted into the bottom of the craft by a retractable stairway. A band played. Hundreds scurried around under the ship shouting farewells. The passengers craned out of the open windows. A Danzig millionaire unbuckled his wristwatch and tossed it out as a farewell present to a relative. There was as much tension and excitement as at the sailing of an ocean liner. The 200 men of the ground crew hauled at the cables and briskly walked the craft, which was attached to a movable mooring mast, out onto the field. At a word from the commander, the cables were thrown off. The huge ship, nearly 1/6 of a mile long and as high as a 13-story building, weighing 236 tons, with its load of fuel, mail, freight, foodstuffs, water, passengers, and crew, lifted gently as thistledown. 106 persons were aboard, the largest number ever to embark on a transoceanic flight. Signal bells jangled in the engine gondolas and the four motors roared. We were off on the 4,300-mile flight to America, suspended in air by 6,710,000 cubic feet of inflammable hydrogen gas. The Hindenburg headed down the Rhine toward the English Channel, a detour of hundreds of miles because France refused to permit the ship to cross her territory. They announced that smoking was prohibited until an hour after sailing, and then it must be done in the hermetically sealed smoking room. After the excitement of the takeoff subsided, passengers inspected their accommodations, which comprised about 4,500 square feet, entirely enclosed within the belly of the craft. On each side of the 25 two-bedded cabins ran a promenade 46 feet in length, flanked by slanting windows, permitting a view outward and downward. Alongside the starboard promenade were a salon and a writing room, furnished with chairs, writing desks, and piano. The dining room, 46 feet long, with two tables seating 50 persons, adjoined the port promenade. The rooms were tastefully decorated. Each small, comfortable cabin had a wash basin with hot and cold water, a tiny desk, a clothes closet, and an electric light. The deck below the cabins housed the shower baths, the kitchens with electric cooking apparatus and refrigeration, the toilets, and the smoking room. Extraordinary precautions had to be taken with the smoking room. You pass through a special entrance constructed like two leaves of a revolving door, and this locked the air in the room. Air pressure was maintained higher inside than outside in order to prevent gas from entering, even if leaks should accidentally develop. The ash receivers automatically closed airtight to extinguish the lighted butts. Drinks were served from a small bar adjoining. Within an hour after the takeoff, the passengers settled down to a routine of playing cards, writing postcards, drinking beer, and eating sandwiches. Professor Franz Wagner, a celebrated European musician, played the piano. Pauline Charteris, wife of the British novelist, and Lady Wilkins, wife of Sir Hubert Wilkins, danced with several of the passengers. Others strolled to the promenade and hung out of the open windows to see the Rhine gleaming in the moonlight 1,000 feet below. I had difficulty convincing myself that we were actually making a historic flight, the first regular passenger service to North America. We slipped through the air with velvety smoothness and almost no vibration. The ship did not sway or buck. The motors hummed but faintly. It was only when you thrust a hand out of the open window into the 80 miles an hour wind that you had any idea of our speed. Unquote. Also in aviation, on May 22nd, Aer Lingus was founded to provide Ireland to England passenger service. The first flight was Dublin to Bristol, May 27, 1936. It was a de Havilland Dragon biplane, a DH-84, carrying the pilot and 6 to 8 passengers, normal cruising speed 114 miles an hour, max speed 134 miles per hour. In the world of ground transportation, Hitler introduced the German people's car, the Volkswagen.
Sie werden dann verstehen, weshalb ich mit rücksichtsloser Entschlossenheit die Vorarbeiten für die Schaffung des deutschen Volkswagens durchführen lasse und zum Abschluss bringen will, und zwar, meine Herren, zum erfolgreichen Abschluss.
Anyone can do it, there's nothing to it, and you'll add it to your dancing menu. It's a bit of trucking, you raise your shoulder and you strut, you dip, you glide, and then you walk a little bit, talk a little bit, talk of love and romance.
But if by chance you think of it, dance.
Everybody's doing it rhythmatic.
There is something new in rhythmatic.
Every little co-ed is flipping a hip with her bow.
And oh, it's so delightful, say professor. Yes sir, yes sir, gotta do that rhythmatic.
In every fraternity and sorority, you'll discover the great majority are
rehearsing to do the new collegiate rhythm.
They say that it's sensational, terrific and educational. Bands will soon be boom booming it. It's got that zoom zooming it all. And you can learn it so easily.
The bass, keep a steady beat. Add a tricky rhythm to tickle your feet. It's a bit of trucking, you raise your shoulder and you strut, you dip, you glide, and then you walk a little bit, talk a little bit, talk of love and romance. Then as you walk and talk a bit, maybe the key will change a bit, and if by chance you think of it, then and oh, it's so delightful, say professor. Yes, sir, yes, sir, gotta do that rhythmatic.
We interrupt the program of Eddie Cantor. This program is interrupted to bring you a special bulletin from the Press Radio Bureau. It is again reported in London tonight that King Edward is considering the advisability of broadcasting a message to his 400 million subjects throughout the world. But no arrangements have been made for such a broadcast so far as is known at this time. This bulletin is from the Press Radio Bureau Further details will be found in your newspaper. Meanwhile, Columbia will continue to interrupt all scheduled programs wherever necessary in order to keep its audience abreast of the latest development in the British crisis. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
The World Series is on the air. This is Ty Tyson broadcasting the play-by-play description of the third game of the 1936 World Series from the Yankee Stadium, New York, through the networks of the National Broadcasting Company.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This afternoon, of course, as Warren Brown told you, we are over at Yankee Stadium. Now here we have the lineup of the afternoon. Warming up down in front of us for the American League New York Yankees is Irving Bump Hadley. Heavy set boy, he's a right-hander. On the other side of home plate, that's Freddie Fitzsimmons, also a right-hander. That's what it looks like at the moment. Hadley for the Yankees and Fitzsimmons for the Giants. At Major Kirk and Furman of the National League, Geisel and Summers of the American League are having a little conference about 20 feet on the third base side of home plate with Gehrig and Jackson. The photographers are leaving the field. Most of the New York Yankees, who are the home club today, they'll be wearing their white uniforms. Their uniform is striped in black. They have black caps on, black numerals, black stockings, and black caps. Today, the Giants, they have been wearing the white and blue uniforms during the first two games. They will occupy the first base dugout. They'll have their gray road uniform trimmed in very bright blue. The conference is still going on as we gaze about the Yankee Stadium here. It's a three-decker, you know. They have the main floor, the mezzanine, and then the upper balcony. The open bleachers out there that seat upwards of around 15, 18,000 people. Every inch of that space has been jammed. It has been utterly impossible to procure a ticket here in New York for this particular game. This day before yesterday, it's a complete sellout. And as we gaze here from our lofty perch in the press box, you know, thousands of people are going to be able to see this ball game this afternoon free of charge. All the tenement houses are all the way from right field out through center and over in left. And thousands of those people are going to be standing in those windows, up on the roof, and on the fire escapes and so forth. They tell me that some of the occupants of those tenement houses are charging as high as a dollar for that lofty perch. It's removed, of course. It's probably 800 feet away from home plate. But they don't care. They couldn't get in the park. And they're mighty happy that they're getting a glimpse of Yankee Stadium.
Professional sports in America were growing more popular as they established fan bases and traditions. The National Football League, a mere 14 years old, held its first ever college draft. The very first draft pick had also been the very first Heisman Trophy winner. He decided not to play pro football, but pursued a respectable career instead. Major League Baseball was seeing a changing of eras. Yankee rookie Joe DiMaggio was just starting his career in the bigs, as Yankee legend Lou Gehrig's career was winding to a close. Gehrig would be all washed up in 3 years, dead in five. DiMaggio would play for another 15 years. Rookie Joe DiMaggio showed he could hit. Really hit. But Lou Gehrig hit better than Joe. DiMaggio had a .323 batting average, 29 homers, and 125 runs batted in. Gehrig hit .354, had 49 round trippers, and hit in 152 runners.
DiMaggio swinging at the whistling line, drive to left center field. It's a base hit. It's taken on the second hop by Ripple. The throw is coming in the second. DiMaggio is racing for it. DiMaggio makes it with a slide and is saved for a double. Spearman calling the play at second base. Now has a little bit of an argument on his hand. Bartell took the throw in, but Dick walks away. DiMaggio slid safely in for a double to left center field. That is just the second hit off Fitzsimmons. Gehrig leading off, first man up in the last half of the second inning. Nobody has scored as yet. Here's the windup, 2-2. There it goes, a long smash deep in the center field. Going, 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 a home run! A home run! Lou Gehrig with that count, 0-2 and strike 2, 6 for that foul! Boy, that was
was a smash. There was nothing spooky about that one. As I said, going, going, going. It went high up over the sign out there, 407 feet away. And Lou Gehrig, smiling and trotting around the bag. He cut first, he cut second, he cut third at home plate, and then tossed his cap to the thousands upon thousands of people here in the Yankee Stadium. And they're off. It's a ball game. And they're full of enthusiasm now.
1936 brought the beginning of the Baseball Hall of Fame and the induction of the first class of Hall of Famers, Ty Cobb, Babe Ruth, Hornace Wagner, Christy Mathewson, and Walter Johnson were enshrined. In 1936, baseball was America's game, but the World Series only belonged to New York City. The New York Giants went up against the very heavily favored New York Yankees.
Cows, and they're afraid to let me milk them.
They're afraid to let you milk them? What kind of cows are they?
Jersey heifers.
They're not Jersey heifers. They're New York Giants.
How do you figure that out?
Because they're afraid of the Yanks.
The Giants surprised the Yankees by winning Game 1 behind star pitcher Carl Hubbell. The Yankees then won Games 2, 3, and 4, bringing the Giants one game away from defeat.
The greatest baseball drama of the year is being enacted in New York. There, the World Series between the Giants and the Yankees is at its peak. This week, the star of the Giants, Carl Hubbell, and the Yankee slugger, Lou Gehrig, have their pictures on the cover of the magazine Time, an honor reserved for the outstanding personalities of the week. The Lux Radio Theater is proud to present both these stars direct from New York. All right, New York, batter up.
You know, Lou, I seem to remember you saying that the Yankees would win the World Series by Monday night.
Well, Carl, can I help it if it rained last Thursday?
It didn't rain today.
No, and it didn't rain Thursday either.
I kind of wish it had, Lou. You Yankees sure gave it to me Sunday, and your homer sensed it.
Well, I was lucky, Carl. It was the biggest curveball in the world, but it was about time. I'd batted against you for quite a while without even getting a loud foul. And that Schumacher, was he tough today?
He sure pissed a ball game. What was it he threw you when he struck you out in the third with the bases full? Or is that too personal?
It's personal, all right. He threw me everything, and then he came through for the third strike with his Sunday pitch. It was a curve ball, and I missed it a mile.
I'll have to get him to teach it to me.
You've got enough right now. What do you say we forget about today and talk about tomorrow? What's going to happen, anyhow?
The Giants are a cinch. A Fitzsimmons will show you more than you saw today.
Oh, sure, the Giants are a cinch. Just like they were in that 18-4 game. It's a good thing for you fellas we let up in that game yesterday.
What do you mean, let up? You got 6 runs in the 9th inning.
That's when we let up. We were afraid if we made any more, you wouldn't show up for the 3rd game.
Say, Lou, you're a great hitter, all right. What's your average so far in the series?
Oh, about 315.
That's pretty good. Of course, I'm hitting 333 myself. Then everybody don't hit like a Hubble.
Watch us tomorrow, slugger.
Lou, we've been doing a lot of ribbon here tonight. There's one thing I want the folks to know, and that is that last week you were voted the most valuable player in the American League for the 4th time.
Yes, and I want the folks to know that you got the same award in the National League.
Yes, but that was before they heard Joey Brown in Elmer the Great.
Speaking of Joe, I bet it's tough on him missing the series. You know how crazy he is about baseball.
I don't know. Seems like he's pitching a pretty good game out in Hollywood tonight. By the way, Lou, who's going to pitch for the Yankees tomorrow?
Looks like Gomez. And then we all go home for the rest of the winter. Why don't you have dinner with me tomorrow night, Carl? We're going to have Yankee bean soup, Yankee pot roast.
Wait till after Wednesday and eat with me. I'll treat you to some of the best giant raspberries you ever saw. Sort of a celebration, you know. And then I'm going back to Meeker, Oklahoma and get in some hunting and fishing. What are you going to do after the series, Lou?
Well, tomorrow night, I'm going to sleep about 2 days. And then I'll figure out some way of spending the big end of the series money. That'll be my toughest problem.
No, Lou, your toughest problem will be to get the big end of the World Series.
Well, Carl, we'll see about that tomorrow. So long. See you at the ballpark. Good night, Hollywood.
Good night, Joey Brown. Keep pitching in there.
The Giants won Game 5 to avoid elimination, but the Yankees won Game 6 to claim the World Championship.
New York City, New York.
The Yankees win World Series in six games and become World's baseball champions for 1936. Town Hall News brings you the outstanding lowlights of the series. First, an interview with the man who almost bought the first ticket for the opening game of the series, Mr. Flubdub D. Fink.
Do I start talking now? Ladies and gentlemen,
just a minute, Flubdub. How did you happen to almost buy the first ticket?
Well, the newspaper said it was going to be a nickel World Series, so I went up to the ticket window with a nickel.
What happened?
I was $9.95 short.
A flash from the third game. Lou Gehrig hits a home run. Town Hall News shows Gehrig coming home.
Come in, Lou.
We present for the first time over the networks the man who broke the World Series hot dog eating record for all times, Mr. Roland Mohn.
How many Frankfurts did you consume, Mr. Mohn? No, no. No, no, just how many? Just give us the number, if you will, Mr. Mohn.
I can't talk, mister. I'm so full of dogs I can only bark.
The first fan to stand up to stretch in the... The first fan to stand up to stretch in the lucky seventh, Mr. Tacit Flex.
Is this the microphone here?
Yes, Mr. Flex. I'm wearing the derby here. Will you, Now, will you, just an informal exhibit, if you will. You just show us how you stretch during the World Series.
Okay, but you'll have to stand back.
All right.
Watch this. Oh, gol darn these tight pants.
The man who yelled the loudest during the entire series, the season's champion heckler, Mr. Raucous Pipes. Mr. Pipes.
Yeah, throw the bum out! Throw the bum out! Get him out of there! Right, John! Throw the bum out! Throw him out! I said you
for just a minute. Huh? Well, life isn't a personal appearance, Mr. Pipes. Now, you just come over to the microphone here.
I don't need no microphone, buddy. When I'm hot, you can hear me in Omaha. Yay! Throw the bum out!
Now, wait a
throw
minute.
Throw the bum out! Get him out!
Wait a minute. Just give us your bellowing high spot from the World Series. Which was your Pulitzer Prize catcall? Do you remember?
Well, in the third game, the umpire called Terry safe, you see, so I swings into action. Yay! Take that bum out! Oh, throw him out, you bum! Throw him out!
Did they throw him out?
I don't know. When I come to, the series was over.
International sports became swept up in the militaristic rivalries of the day. Former world heavyweight boxing champion and well-known German Max Schmeling traveled to New York to fight up-and-coming young phenomena Joe Louis. Louis was favored 10-1. Louis was obviously a champion in the making, while Schmeling was a has-been who hadn't got the message yet. They said Schmeling was too old, too slow, and too vulnerable to Joe Louis's lightning-fast punches.
Bud incidentally told me, Mr. Snee, that you have written and dedicated a song to Mr. Joe Louis. Is that right?
Yes.
You have, huh?
I have.
How'd you come to do that?
Well, I was reading, you know, as you'll see in the words when I sing the song, you know, whenever you see the newsreel of Joe and the show, the slow motion.
Uh-huh.
Well, after he knocks his man out, it looks like he's trucking, you know, that more.
And that gave you the idea, hey?
Yes, sir.
Have you sung the song for Mr. Louis?
Yes, I sang it for him up in Lafayetteville.
Well, I guess he must have liked it or you wouldn't be here to talk about it. You wouldn't care to predict the winner of the fight tomorrow night, would you?
Well, Mr. Allen, how can Joe Louis?
Well, the only one I can think to go with for that, Mr. Snead, is that the reason they're holding the fight in June is so that Schmeling will be sure to see the fourth. I mean, but you're going... What? Well, I think we can both retire after that little bit of banter, Mr. Snead. But what do you call your song?
Joe Louis.
Joe Louis. Well, all right, you go right ahead. You're going to play your own accompaniment on the guitar, huh?
Yes.
You all set?
Yes.
All right, thank you.
Oh, but do let do do bip the hallyah, hallyah. Can anybody tell me who's the greatest new sensation? The fistic marvel of the age, credit to the nation. A boy who won the girlie's heart, the idol of his mama. If you don't know, I'll have you know that it is the brown bomber. He's Big Joe Louis from Alabama. He don't play bridge, but he sure can slam. He knocks him down, he knocks him round. Turns around and trucks on down. He jabs the left. He hooks a right, hooks left with all his might. He doesn't smile, he doesn't frown, just turns around and trucks on down. Oh, Joe, he's a natural trucker. Oh, Joe, say any guy who fights him is a sucker. Seems those guys all trust to luck, then they all forget to duck. Now that's time, he goes to town, turns around and trucks on down.
But sometimes fights don't turn out as people expect. That's why they fight the fights. And this fight surprised everybody.
45,000 at Yankee Stadium. Joe Louis, one of the hottest properties in town. 23 fights, undefeated. A professional for less than 2 years. And the aim for both these men, of course, the world title currently held by James J. Braddock. And for Schmeling, who lost his title in 1932 to Jack Sharkey, a chance to regain centre stage. Oddsmakers, incidentally, making Lewis's hotter favourite as 10-1 on for this. A little bit of bad blood generated by the media in the run-up to this fight. Adolf Hitler due to be staging the Olympics in Berlin shortly after this. And Lewis having a good round in the third. Good uppercut in there, good right hand. And Schmeling really is eating up that jab again and again. I wonder how long it's going to be before Lewis really starts to try to unload. Damon Runyon, no less, said about Joe Lewis in the build-up to this fight. More's been written about him in the last couple of years than any other single living man apart from Charles Lindbergh. Oh, good right hand from Schmeling. And right on the temple, and Lewis is on wobbly legs. And he's got him again. Another big right hand, and Lewis down. That's down for the first time in his professional career. Two right hands from Schmeling, absolutely scrambling his senses. Well, what a huge upset this would be. Lewis regaining composure well, but Schmeling knows now that he can really hurt this man. The New York Daily News said in the run-up to this fight, Joe Lewis, a sucker for the right hand, and he's been caught by two big right hands in this round, and Schmeling looking to nail him again. Well, there goes the bell to end the fourth, and it couldn't come too soon. Well, into round five, scheduled to go 15 rounds. And Schmeling now looking to unload once more with that right over the top. Schmeling, a professional since 1924, loads of experience, and at the moment, he's starting to give young Joe Lewis a little bit of a boxing lesson. He's catching him time and again. Lewis has really got to keep that left hand up. And there again, over the top with the right hand. Lewis picking him up a couple of times with the jab and then comes back the right hand with interest. May have been two or three punches from Lewis as against one from Schmeling, but the power shot, which surely is going to take its toll if he continues to be able to land it, came from Schmeling. Schmeling, who lost his title in 1932, he's had a little bit of a checkered record since then, only won 4 of 7, but my word, he's giving Lewis all the problems he can handle. And another right over the top. Referee Arthur Donovan separating them, and that's the bell to end the period. Big fifth round again to Schmeling, and very definitely the German in command as they come into round six. Lewis's mother, incidentally, is left ringside, distressed by what she was seeing. Lewis so used to just steamrolling opponents over, and perhaps to some extent, maybe believing in his own hype. Here he's found a man who won't be intimidated, but there's a good left into the body from Lewis. Good power shot from the youngster. And another one. This is better work from Lewis. And Lewis having his best round for some time, doubling up his punch as well. And Schmeling, for the first time for several rounds, really made to backpedal, and the crowd responding. Schmeling just looking as though he's tending to lose the initiative a touch at this stage. And Lewis working him over again. Good body shots. It's the left hook into the ribcage that's causing the damage. Remember, Lewis down in the fourth round, in all sorts of trouble then. He's come back well and now carrying the round, the fight and the round to Schmeling. Good uppercut from Schmeling in there as Lewis tried to tee him off with big hooks. And another good hook from Schmeling. Amazing what a difference a couple of good shots can make. Suddenly, Lewis in reverse gear, and another good uppercut from Schmeling, and another one. Both right hands. Oh, good right hand from Schmeling. Just as I was about to say, you'd like to see more authority in Lewis's jab. In came that right again over the top. And Lewis has really got to snap that punch more. Right over the top again from Smelling. And it really is beginning to develop a predictability in this round. He's caught it with three or four tremendous shots over the top, Smelling. And Lewis is losing whatever mobility he had in the first place in those legs. Not one of the great fancy dance so far as movement's concerned, Joe Lewis, but he's undoubtedly been hurt by those three or four big right hands from the German. Lewis had three or four good rounds in the middle of the fight, but now Schmeling is coming on strong, and he begins this period with another ramrod right. Percussive blow into the side of Lewis's face. Well, that's probably the best shot which Lewis has thrown for some time. The crowd suspecting it might have been a bit low, but Lewis not ticked off. A few boos and jeers. And there goes Schmeling once more. And Lewis is starting to get on the receiving end of a beating. All the big shots from the German. At no stage has Schmeling truly looked as though he's been hurt by the much-touted firepower of Joe Lewis. Schmeling now, you get the impression, looking to measure Lewis with that right hand. Lewis, the younger man, you'd expect him to come on strong, maybe in the closing stages of this contest. Perhaps he's got the advantages of superior fitness. Of course, with tremendous support in this crowd. Oh, and there's another tremendous right hand on the left hook, and Lewis looks in trouble. Lewis is in trouble on the ropes. He's got to hold on and got to buy time, and it doesn't help him one jot that the referee splits him there. Another right over the top from Schmeling. Oh, and these are anxious moments for Joe Lewis Barrow. Terrific shot again from Schmeling, and he's hitting Lewis almost at will now with that right hand and the uppercut. And Lewis looks like a man about to fall. Oh, and there he goes! The right hand has been the danger punch throughout, and Lewis surely can't get up from that. The fight's all over, it's one of the great upsets, and the huge underdog from Germany, Max Schmeling, is declared the winner, and scenes of pandemonium in New York.
Schmeling returned to Germany a national hero, and living proof of the superiority of the German race.
What's the idea, Billy? Are you on his side?
Now, wait a minute. Listen, genius. You just talked yourself out of $1 million. At this moment, who ever heard of Greta Muller? Nobody. But if she wins the Olympics, she'll be as well known as Jack Dempsey or Lindbergh or Campbell Soup. Don't you see? He's taking away a skater, and he'll give you back a world champion.
Hitler's capital of Berlin hosted the 1936 Summer Olympics. The Nazis had instituted an Aryans-only policy for German athletics, and Hitler was expecting a dominant performance from his master race. And the Germans did win the most gold medals, the most silver medals, and the most bronze medals of any country. But American track and field star Jesse Owens was the dominant individual athlete, winning 4 gold medals and sweeping every one of his events.
Owens, how many gold medals do you hope to win? Wie viele Goldmedaillen wollen Sie eigentlich wegschleppen?
It's the desire of every athlete to win a first place in the Olympic Games.
And since I'm in 3 events, I hope to emerge with 3 victories. I hope.
3. Also 3 bescheidene Goldmedaillen will Herr Owens mitnehmen, nämlich 100 Meter, 100 Meters,
200 Meters,
200 Meters und
Broadjump.
Und Weitsprung. Das genügt dafür, ein einzelner Sterbt.
These were the first Olympics to be broadcast on TV. Of course, no one owned a TV, but 25 viewing rooms were set up in the greater Berlin area.
Oh, hello, Mr. DeMille. Gee, you're cute.
Well, you're not so bad. We're on the air, Miss Newell.
Oh, just like a radio program?
Practically the same.
And everybody hears whatever I say?
Yes, they do.
Oh, goody. Hello, Jack. Hello, Mortimer.
Just a minute.
Mr. Jacoby.
Just a minute. Don't say anything until I ask you a question. Then talk straight into this. This is a microphone, Miss Newell, see? Microphone.
But of course. An apparatus for converting audio energy into electrical energy. Anybody knows that.
Well, upon my word.
Microphone, it comes from the Greek word micros, meaning small.
Oh, you know a little Greek.
Not anymore. I haven't seen him in years. Oh, Nicholas.
Miss Newell, you're quite an enigma.
Oh, and I like you, too.
What I'm struggling to determine is how you got into pictures.
Well, when I was in high school...
You were in high school?
I'll thank you for not interrupting me, sir.
But how did you get into pictures?
Well, a Spanish boy I knew taught me to speak Spanish, and I got a job in a foreign language studio. After that, I was with Jean Harlow's... I was Jean Harlow's stand-in at Metro, and then I went to Warner Brothers.
Mm-hmm. Are all showgirls like you, are they?
Miss DeMille, you say the nicest things.
Oh, well. What are your latest pictures?
Stage Struck, Cain and Mabel, and now Gold Diggers.
Do you smoke or drink?
Thanks, but hadn't we better wait till we're through?
What's a showgirl's idea of marriage?
Well, it's like this. If a man came along with plenty of money, I think most of us would like to get married, providing we fell in love. That's important, too. But personally, if a man without money wanted to marry, I don't think it would be fair to either of us. You see, showgirls are really too independent to...
You know, I'm afraid... Right. I'm afraid that the pilot of that plane is going to find himself in a spin with all you gold diggers aboard. Do you like the idea of flying?
Swell, the only trouble is that with 12 of us in one plane, there won't be much room left for clothes. But we know how to get around that.
How?
Did you ever hear of Lux Flakes?
No, sounds familiar.
They solve our problem. Each night when we stop off at a hotel, we do a little washing with Lux Flakes. We use Lux all the time at the studio for our sweaters and costumes. Mm-hmm. And we use it on our trip, not only for convenience, but because we want to look our best always. You ought to try it sometime.
I will. Sounds like lots of fun.
Yes, indeed, Mr. DeMille. This has been lots of fun. If I haven't given the audience a very concrete idea of what a Hollywood showgirl is really like, maybe it's because we're actually no different than other girls. No smarter and, well, I guess no dumber. Just trying to make good and waiting for the right man. Thanks loads and good night.
Good night, Miss Newell.
I don't know, there's something about radio. It's the new medium of entertainment. Years ago, when there were more theaters and things, people used to go around hating the sight of actors. But today, millions of people are walking around the country hating actors by sound. They don't know even know what the people they hate look like. They have to wait for television to come in.
In 1936, New Zealand began broadcasting parliamentary debate on New Zealand radio. All over the world, radio was now the primary way politicians talked to their country.
There are over 1,500 people gathered here in Town Hall, and among them a number of distinguished guests from abroad, officials of the broadcasting companies in 15 foreign countries, have come to New York this month to participate in the celebration of the National Broadcasting Company's 10th anniversary. A number of these broadcasting officials are in our audience this evening. We are particularly happy to welcome them here to Town Hall. This subject may have been of special interest to some of these European broadcasters, and if you gentlemen, guests of the National Broadcasting Company, have any questions you'd like to ask first, before we go on with the question period, let's have them, please. Will you rise and state your name and where you're from?
In America, radios were everywhere. Almost every home had one. In 1930, not a single automobile company built a radio into their cars. But by 1936, 75% of automobiles had radios as standard equipment.
Here they come, the smart set.
Shall I call your taxi, Mrs. Vandermorgan?
Yes, and get me one with a radio doorman. It's Town Hall tonight.
More people were listening to radio, more hours of more days. And the shows they were listening to were changing.
Come here, Lynn. Come here and do some of your imitations.
Well, if you think they're good enough.
Good enough. Jack, give him some incidental music, will you?
My time is your time. Your time is my time. Hi-ho, everyone. This is Rudy Valley in the Royal Gelatin Program. Celebrating my 7th anniversary, and it affords me a great pleasure to present Fred Allen. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is your old friend, Fred Allen. Well, as I live and try to talk out of the left side of my mouth so I can sprinkle this gardenia in my lapel, if it isn't my old friend Arthur Tracy, the street singer.
Martha, rambling rose of the wild. Divine.
Greetings and salutations, ladies and gentlemen. This is the old maestro, Ben Burley and all the lads, wishing you a bit of a tweet-tweet and ball and cheerio, so help me yowza. And now, presenting to you guys and you gals, this is Richmond's little boy, Harry.
Say, I know why I've waited yet there, and I know just why I've been blue. And I prayed each night for someone exactly like you. Oh, thank you, you gorgeous people. But you hear that music, don't you? You know who that is? That's my very dear friend and brilliant master of ceremonies, Bing Crosby.
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Bing Crosby in the Kraft Music Hall. If my eyes don't deceive me, here comes the first citizen of Van Buren, Arkansas, Mr. Robin Burns.
Thank you, Bing. You know, Bing, I certainly appreciate being on this program with you, but I ain't going to play my bazooka tonight. Instead, I'm going to ask you to sing an old favorite of yours, I Can't Escape From You.
Why, of course, Bob. Swing it, Jimmy. I'm free as the wandering breeze. I'm free to wander any place I please, and yet I can't escape from you. Thank you. Now it's a privilege to present His Highness of Heidi High and Hody Ho, Cab Calloway.
Yeah, man!
1936 was a wake-up call for NBC, the original network. Once, only NBC Red Network or NBC Blue Network showed up in the national ratings. But in 1936, the upstart network, Columbia, suddenly led in the ratings.
This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
The previous year, CBS had only two shows in the top 10, March of Time and Burns and Allen. The other eight of the top 10 were all NBC shows led by Major Bowes at number one. In 1936, Columbia took six of the top 10, including number one, Eddie Cantor's Texaco Town. 2 years before, CBS had signed Cantor away from NBC, a move that was now paying off big time.
About sweethearts, make her sing it.
Gee, that's a good suggestion, Bobby. Where did you learn such grand showmanship?
I learned it from radio's greatest showman.
Thanks.
Yes, sir. I listen to Major Bowes every Thursday.
Quiet. Go ahead, Deanna.
Major Bowes had also jumped to Columbia for 1936, and his amateur hour was still a ratings bonanza. The show came in at number five. Other CBS shows in the top ten were Lux Radio Theater, Al Jolson, and Burns and Allen.
Well, Gracie, say how do.
How do, George?
Well, now say something to the boys.
Oh, what do you want me to say to them?
Well, why don't you say something you think the boys would like?
Something the boys would like?
Yeah.
Boys, Gene Harlow.
Oh, thanks, Gracie. Thank you. Now, I think you want to say hello to New Orleans.
Why?
Why? Ken Niles just told the people that you were going to say something about New Orleans.
Oh, don't listen to Ken Niles. That's just gossip.
Mm.
And gossip is nothing but idle rumors. And idle rumors are rumors that can't pay their room rent. And room rent
Gracie,
is a thing...
Gracie, are you talking about rumors or rumors?
Rumors are rumors.
Rumors.
Say, that reminds me. Why are they making such a fuss over Simone?
Simone?
Yeah.
Well, she has two names that sound exactly alike.
Oh, yeah? What about the three Gracies?
Say, Tony, I need a little help.
George, don't count on me tonight. I'm in the middle of a picture, and talk about hard work. Do you know that from 9 o'clock this morning until 7 o'clock tonight, I've done nothing but kiss Alice Faye?
Well, that's nice work if you can get it.
I don't mean that kissing Alice Faye isn't swell, but... it's just work for me during the day and takes all the romance out of me for my date tonight.
Mm. And who've you got a date with tonight?
Alice Faye.
Alice Faye, retake, Faye.
Well, I don't mind, Tony. If you've got a date with Alice Faye tonight, you just keep it.
Yeah.
Of course, I was going to ask you to take me home tonight, but I don't expect you to break your date with Alice Faye. But I do want to tell you that our sponsor phoned me and he said... Gracie, if you're not happy with your new singer, just say the word and we'll get rid of him. That's all.
That's all. Well, Tony, it looks like you're on a spot.
Well, Gracie, I haven't exactly got a date with Alice Faye.
Oh, well, now, far be me from it to break up any date,
oh, yeah.
Tony.
Far be me from it.
You just keep your date with Alice Faye, especially tonight, while you still got a salary coming in.
Mm. Gracie, when did the sponsor phone you?
Oh, you don't have to worry, George. He thinks you're swell.
Hmm. You're sure he's going to let me stay on the program?
Oh, sure. As a matter of fact, you can even go out with Alice Faye and nothing will happen.
Thanks. Gracie, I have an idea that maybe you like Tony Martin.
Oh. You think of the silliest things, George.
Don't I?
Yes. Well, I was out with a very adorable man last night.
Is that so?
Mm.
I suppose it's some relative?
No, not yet. It's Clark Abel.
Not yet. Clark Abel. Were you out with Clark Abel last night?
Well, it's better than staying home alone.
I think so.
Well, anyway, here's what happened. I was at a party minding my own business, and Clark Abel came over, and he said, are you Gracie Allen? And I said, yes. And he said, how about sitting on my lap, Gracie? And I figured he wasn't sitting on it, and I had to sit someplace.
So you sat down on his lap.
Yes, and then my mother hollered. She said, Gracie, get up, get up.
Did you get up?
Oh, yeah, I jumped up, and I had breakfast, and I said to my mother, I said, why did you wake me up, Mama? A beautiful dream, I told her.
You said that to your mother? Oh, you dreamt you were out with Clark Abel.
Sure.
Did you ever dream you went out with me?
No, I never have nightmares.
Well, that's a pretty thought.
Gracie, as long as you're dreaming, how about dreaming I'm taking you to the Brown Derby restaurant tonight?
Oh, thanks, Tony, but that place is too crowded.
Mm. You can't dream you're going to the Brown Derby restaurant because it's too crowded?
Oh, yeah. I had to stand up in bed 2 hours the other night waiting to get a table.
Well, you ought to make your reservations before you go to bed. Either that or go to bed earlier so that you could get there sooner.
Well, that's a good idea.
Yeah.
You know, once I dreamt I was invited to the White House to visit President Roosevelt, but I didn't go.
Why?
Well, I wasn't dressed properly for it.
I see. Well, you ought to go to some exclusive foyer in your dreams and get yourself a fur coat.
Oh, I saw a beautiful mink coat last night that I liked.
Was it a dream?
Oh, I'll say it was a dream, and only $2,500, too.
Mm. Well, when you go to sleep tonight, just dream that I bought it for you.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah.
You know, Daddy jumped to get a pearl necklace for me the other night.
Is that so?
Yes, and then the dream cops came and arrested him.
Hmm, I see. Took him away in a little dream wagon.
Yes. Oh, and that was about 6 months ago, and Daddy is still dreaming.
In bed, huh?
No, in jail.
In jail, that's your daddy. That's
Daddy. Gracie, don't you ever dream about me.
Oh, sure, Henry. I dreamt about you last night.
You did?
Mm-hmm. I dreamt I was out dancing with you, but when I woke up, I discovered it was my little nephew pounding my feet with a hammer.
Mm. Please, Donald, come on, Gracie.
In the 1936 radio ratings, only superstars Jack Benny, Bing Crosby, Amos and Andy, and Fred Allen landed top 10 spots for NBC Red. NBC Blue had none.
And now from Baltimore also, Miss Helen Allison. How are you tonight, Miss Allison?
I'm very well, thank you.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. And you are an impersonator?
That's right.
You are, huh? Do you impersonate birds and woodchucks and things like that, or?
Oh, no, comedians.
Oh, comedians, huh? Well, what comedians do you impersonate?
Well, I impersonate a Mr. Allen. Do you, you know, you get around a little, I thought maybe.
Oh, Mr. Allen. On days when I'm not myself, I run across him occasionally. do you impersonate me?
I make an attempt at it.
Do you? And just me, or do you do Portland, too?
I do Portland also.
Oh, that. How did you decide, of all the people in the world, how did you decide to select us?
I always admired your style of acting.
Well, that's swell.
I just...
Well, I wanted to get your name and address. People often ask me if we have a fan, and I just sort of fuss around and don't have much to say. But I'm going to ask you to go right ahead. I know you don't want me to butt in here. You just go right ahead and do what you'd like to do.
Thank you, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Now, before booting the drop kick of fun, I'll read you the town hall bulletin for tonight. Hodge White, plain and fancy grocer.
Mr. Allen! Mr. Allen!
Quiet, please. If that's Pocahontas paging John Smith, I'll paddle your little canoe if I come down there. Hello? Well, sir, they left when I left Maine. They didn't know Portland would follow through. I'll say, and I'm here to sell you a magazine. A magazine? Yes, I'm working Papa's way through college. Oh, I get it. Papa wants to become a G-man. Well, not exactly. Berkeley, Papa's willing to start at Z and work his way up. He'll get as far as X marks the spot. Run along, I'm busy. Is that nice? Don't be shy. Buy something. Oh, give me liberty or give me death. I haven't got those, but I'll give you a true detective. That's on it. Goodbye, Portland. Tally ho!
Amos and Andy were celebrating 8 years on NBC. They, more than any other radio act, were responsible for driving the sales of radios into the millions, and then tens of millions. Amos and Andy were the closest thing to a tradition the radio world had. They went national on NBC in 1928, which marks the start of the golden age of radio, in my humble opinion. There was no rating system at that time, but there was no doubt, hands down, Amos and Andy were by far the most popular thing on radio. In 1930, the first radio ratings measured more than twice the audience for Amos and Andy than the second place radio show. Since the rating systems began, Amos and Andy had never not been in the top 10 shows. Amos and Andy finished first in the ratings twice, 10th in the ratings twice, and once each 6th, 7th, and 8th in the years 1930 through 1936. They would remain on the radio, in one format or another, until 1969, when many of their golden age peers had faded away.
First, I want to tell you that it has been a great pleasure for me to work with the two boys whom I have listened to for many years. Whenever the opportunity presents itself, I invariably listen to Amos and Andy. This is their anniversary, the starting of their 8th year on the network. I have read their biography. Many of you know this. But for the benefit of those who may not be familiar with the facts, here they are. These boys started working with colored dialect in January 1926 under the name of Sam and Henry. This program, which was similar to Amos and Andy, was broadcast in the early days of radio over WGN in Chicago. After 2 years of Sam and Henry, the boys changed their names to Amos and Andy. In other words, Amos and Andy was actually started in March 1928. They broadcast at that time over station WMAQ in Chicago, with additional stations added by means of electrical transcription. But it was 7 years ago tonight that they started on what might be called the big time. As you all know, they have established a record in radio broadcasting. They have received today many congratulatory messages from people in every walk of life. They deserve it. Tonight's episode, in which I had the pleasure of participating, was their 2,395th day of broadcast. As you know, the boys broadcast twice each day. I think these boys should be congratulated on their long record of daily broadcasting, of these episodes which carries with it a streak of not only human interest, but of philosophy, which I have often enjoyed myself. Their humorous episodes have been a joy to many people for an awful long time. I congratulate these boys not only upon their ability to impersonate these characters, all of which they do themselves, but for writing this material each day. They are seated by me now, squirming in their chairs. Now, I'm going to ask them to say just a few words. It's been a pleasure to have had the opportunity of talking to you. I thank you. And here they are, Ames and Andy.
Well, that's very nice of you, Mr. Houston, and it's certainly nice of you to say all those sweet things.
Yeah, even me. I was blushing. It ain't nobody ever heard me blush on the radio.
Well, our program is almost up. We just want to tell our listeners how grateful we are to have passed another milestone in radio broadcasting. We've been grateful to the cooperation we've received here in Hollywood. We want to thank Major Law for his kindness, the Pepsi and Company for their nice message, Mr. Houston for his cordial greeting. And we want to tell you how grateful we are to you listeners who make these anniversaries possible. We want to thank you and tell you we're very, very thrilled tonight to say good night.
Good night, folks.
Keep smiling at trouble, for trouble's a bubble, and bubbles will soon go away. With ever a gladness and never a sadness. We'd weary of life in a day. Be like the violets that go neath a chill winter snow. They bravely wait till it's May. Keep smiling at trouble, for trouble's a bubble, and bubbles will soon blow away. When you've learned that life is what you make it, then you know the secret of it all. Find your share of happiness and take it. Make life a song as you go along. Keep smiling at trouble, but trouble's a bubble, and little bubbles they'll soon go away. With ever a gladness and nothing but sadness, we'd weary of life in a day. Be like the violet that goes in the pale winter snow. They bravely wait till it's May. So just smile at trouble, for trouble's a bubble, and bubbles will soon blow away.
Mutual Broadcasting System is now coast to coast.
While CBS and NBC fought it out in the ratings, the scrappy little network who hadn't yet made the top 20 in the ratings, Mutual Broadcasting, was slowly growing. Mutual finally gained a station in the Los Angeles market, making this patchwork association of independent stations a genuine nationwide network.
Good evening, everyone. This is Gabriel Heater, privileged in a history-making moment to welcome the Mutual Network coast to coast. Stations of Don Lee Network, Central States Broadcasting System, the Iowa Network, KFEL Denver, WHB Kansas City, and many new affiliates. We send greetings to KGMB Honolulu, whose audience has joined to our network tonight. A great and vital link in radio, rich in tradition of high public service, completes a march of progress and now spans America coast to coast. Combining in a vast network stations whose high standards of public performance have won millions of loyal friends. A final triumph and achievement which assures our radio audience a never-increasing standard of rich entertainment. No man is better qualified to comment on such history-making progress than Anning Prowl, chairman of our Federal Communications Commission. We now take you to Commissioner Prowl, who will speak from studios of member station WOL in Washington, D.C.
Ladies and gentlemen, I address you first as a messenger and quote a communication received from the President of the United States. The White House, Washington, December 23rd, 1936. Honorable Anning S. Prowl, Chairman, Federal Communications Commission, Washington, D.C. My dear Mr. Chairman, through the coast-to-coast service which is being inaugurated by the Mutual Broadcasting System, more people in widely separated parts of our country will hear the same program simultaneously. Every added potential listener adds to the responsibility which always follows the broadcaster, the responsibility of seeing that the program is worthy of its audience. The measure of the success or failure of a broadcaster in rendering a public service must be not how many people he reaches, but the character of the program he offers to those whom he reaches. in extending my congratulations upon the inauguration of this expanded broadcast service, I unite with them in the sincere hope that the programs which are to go out over this enlarged area will be commensurate with the opportunity for increased service. Very sincerely yours, Franklin D. Roosevelt.
In 1936, one of the most famous of all old-time radio shows, The Green Hornet, premiered in the local Detroit market on WXYZ. Hornet was created by the creators of The Lone Ranger, and Mutual would soon take the Hornet national. The first radio quiz show, Professor Quiz, premiered on CBS in 1936. And on November 17, 1936, Edgar Bergen and Charlie McCarthy first performed on national radio with a guest appearance on Rudy Valley's show. They would soon have a hit show of their own.
People have been asking me for the last 2 days, why put a ventriloquist on the air? The answer is, why not? True, our ventriloquist, Edgar Bergen, is an unusual one, sort of Noel Coward or perhaps Fred Allen among ventriloquists. A dexterous fellow who depends more upon the cleverness and wit of his material than upon the believe-it-or-not nature of his delivery. At Elsa Maxwell's most recent Star Spangled Party, the local smart set went smartly mad over Mr. Bergen, and currently he is entertaining the white tie folks at the Rainbow Room. Mr. Bergen works with a dummy, several of them, in fact, but this one is a typical ventriloquist dummy, except that it is arrayed in top hat and tails. Just imagine the dummy, and take my word for it that both voices you will hear are owned and operated by just one man, Edgar Bergen.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As Rudy told you, my friend here is arrayed in considerable splendor.
Yes, indeedy.
Yes. And now, young man, I would like to know why you're dressed in tails and top hat and monocle. There must be a story in back of all that.
Oh, there is, stranger?
Yes.
Oh, there is. There's a long story.
I imagine so.
A long story. And a dirty one, too.
I imagine so. Well, where did the money come from?
Oh, the Mazuma.
Yes.
Well, I'll tell you.
I wish you would.
You see, my stepfather...
Yes?
He passed away.
I see.
And when he died, he left me 200 smackers.
Oh, he did.
Yes.
I see. Well, I'm sorry to hear about your stepfather.
What's the matter? What did he do now?
No, I mean, passing away.
Oh, yes, of course. Yes, yes. Well, what about it?
Well, I mean, it's sad.
Oh, yes. Yes, it was.
Yes.
Yes, it was sad, really.
Yes.
But then, on the other hand, 200 bucks ain't to be sneezed at either.
No, you're right. Well, tell me, is your mother living yet?
No, not yet.
Not yet. No, I see.
No, she isn't.
Well, what is the name, if I may ask?
The name?
Yes.
Now that I have money...
I see.
It's, Denby.
Denby.
Oh, yes, Denby. I'm one of the Fishwell Denbys.
Oh, I see.
One of the Walton on the Thames official Denbys. Oh.
Well, you must be from the other side.
Oh, definitely.
Yes.
But way on the other side.
Yes, yes.
Of the tracks.
I imagine so. You like it over in England?
Oh, it's simply marvelous.
I imagine so.
Yes.
Yes. Well, what do you like most of all?
I love to go grouse hunting in the Scottish uplands.
I see. Grouse hunting.
Yes, it's such fun shooting,
I suppose so.
Oh, yes, I go every autumnal.
You do?
Mm-hmm.
Well, did you have any luck this fall shooting?
Oh, definitely.
Oh, fine.
The very first day out, I got 3 Cocker Spaniels.
Oh, you did?
And the second day, I got a horse.
A horse, yes.
And my host.
And your host, yes.
I don't miss a darn thing.
I know it is.
If it moves, I shoot.
I see.
Oh, it's good fun.
I imagine so.
Yes.
Well, young man, I don't believe you were grouse shooting.
You don't?
No. And I don't believe you were over in England.
Oh, come now. Don't be a twerp.
Well, I do.
You don't believe me?
I don't believe you.
Uh-huh.
And I don't believe your name is Demby.
Oh, you don't?
No.
That's embarrassing.
Yes, it is.
Well, I say it is. It is.
I don't believe you.
You don't believe me, huh?
I don't believe you.
Uh-huh. Well, heck, I tried.
Yes, I know. So what is it?
Charlie McCarthy.
Oh, I see.
But how could you tell?
Well, you see, Charlie, I am a mind reader.
Is that so?
Yes. And I am a student of psychic phenomena.
Oh, boo-boo-boo.
Yes.
The kid's clever.
Yes. Would you like a demonstration of my crystal reading?
Yes, I would. I'd enjoy it. Just a spot of it.
Yes. You see, I have a crystal here.
Yes, so you have.
Yes.
What does it do?
Well, you see, it helps me to focus my attention.
Uh-huh.
In order for me to give you a reading, I have to go into a trance.
Oh, must you?
Yes.
Well, I'll wait here.
All right.
But what does the crystal, the globule, what does it do?
Well, when I gaze into the crystal,
uh-huh,
everything goes out of focus.
Uh-huh.
And it seems to whirl round and round.
Is that so?
Yes.
Marvelous.
Yes. It's just like gazing into a whirlpool.
A whirlpool?
Yes.
What's a whirlpool?
What is a whirlpool?
Now, I ask you first.
All right. You have never seen a whirlpool?
No.
I see.
Awfully sorry.
Oh, that's all.
I never have, you know, actually.
I see.
Awfully sorry.
That's all right.
I hate myself for not having done it.
Oh, that's...
I feel a perfect cad, don't you know?
Oh, that's all right. Well, if you haven't, then of course you haven't.
Well, that's the way I feel about it.
Yes.
I will say this, though. Not so long ago, I fell in a pool.
Oh, you fell in a pool?
Yes.
But it wasn't a whirlpool?
No. Awfully sorry.
Oh, that's all right.
It was a cesspool. A cesspool. I was sorry for that, too.
I imagine. But my good young man, that is neither here nor there.
No, that was up in Connecticut.
Oh. Well, now, what would you like to have me tell you about the future while I have the crystal here?
Would you tell me if there's any work in sight?
Any work?
Yes.
You're interested in a position?
Mildly, yes.
I see. Well, yes, Charlie, I do see a position here.
Oh, goody, goody, goody.
Yes. I suppose you would like to know something about the nature of this work?
Yes, I would.
Yes. And something about the future of the position?
Yes, I would, yes. And something about the salary, too.
The salary, yes. Of course there is the salary.
Well, I hope so, yes.
Yes. Well, the salary, it will be a small starting salary.
A small starting salary.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But it will start.
Oh, it will start, yes.
Could you say how small?
Well, no, I can't say that.
They don't make money that small.
Oh, yes. Yes.
But
I'm sure they will pay you what you're worth.
Yeah, well, I would be interested in that kind of money.
Oh, I see. But I'm afraid the position won't do you much good.
Why, what's the matter?
Well, it seems that your cocktail parties interfere with your work.
Oh, I wouldn't say that.
It looks very bad, young man.
Oh, well, I never overdo those things.
Oh, you don't?
No, I never take more than four or five scotch and sodas.
Four or five scotch and sodas?
Yeah, that's all.
Oh, my goodness.
What's that?
Why, I should think four or five scotch and sodas would make you awfully drunk.
Yeah, well, it helps.
It helps. Don't you know, young man, that alcohol...
Yeah?
Alcohol, it's nothing but slow poison.
Is what?
It's slow poison.
Is that so?
Yes.
Slow poison?
That's what it is.
Slow poison.
Yes.
Well, I'm in no hurry.
Well, then it's all right.
And 1936 brought the beginnings of the greatest mock feud in the history of show business, Jack Benny and Fred Allen.
What
Christmas cheer. I've got a house full of strange people, a couple of rented kids eating my food, stand-ins for relatives taking my presents, and I don't know a soul in the joint.
The girls will introduce you, Mr. Allen.
I don't want to be introduced. I want to spend the day in bed, sleeping.
You'll never be missed. The party will still go on.
Yes. You see, the Let Us Make Your Christmas Merry Incorporated will make merry regardless.
We guarantee tinsel bedlam complete for $100.
Well, can't you hold the party someplace else?
Yes, but it'll cost you $50 extra.
Fine, I'll give you $100 more to hold the party at Jack Benny's.
Oh, no, no, no. Any place but there.
Why can't I have my Christmas party at Jack's house?
He gave us $200 to hold his party at your house.
Buck Benny hides again, eh? So long, girls. Alfie the Saint Portland.
Alf Pally Ho!
A feud is born. Ratings increase. In the next few years, a couple of films get made based on the feud, and good friends Jack and Fred laugh all the way to the bank.
This is Fred Allen saying good night, ladies and gentlemen, and inviting you to another hour of smiles next Wednesday evening at the Old Town Hall. And good news, ladies and gentlemen, Jack Benny and Mary Livingston will be our guest stars at the Town Hall next Wednesday evening. So don't forget, you're all invited. Good night.
This day and age we're living in gives cause for apprehension, with speed and new invention and things like third dimension. Yet we get a trifle weary with Mr. Einstein's theory, so we must get down to earth at times, relax, relieve the tension. No matter what the progress or what may yet be proved, the simple facts of life are such, they cannot be removed. You must remember this, a kiss is still a kiss, a sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. And when two lovers woo, they still say I love you, on that you can rely. No matter what the future brings as time goes by. Moonlight and love songs never out of date, hearts full of passion, jealousy and hate. Woman needs man, and man must have his mate. That no one can deny. It's still the same old story, a fight for love and glory, a case of do or die. The world will always welcome lovers as time goes by.
One of the big events of 1936 was the cross-country move of the Lux Radio Theater Show. At the beginning of the 1935-36 radio season, the show was broadcast from New York and featured Broadway actors in edited adaptions of Broadway plays. At the beginning of the 1936-1937 radio series, the Lux Radio Theater was broadcasting film stars performing film adaptions from Hollywood. Let's listen to the premiere episode. Broadcast from Hollywood, June 1, 1936, Lux Radio Theater presents The Legionnaire and the Lady.
Hollywood, California, Monday, June 1st, 1936. ¶¶ and gentlemen, we have grand news for you tonight. For the Lux Radio Theater has moved to Hollywood. And here we are in a theater of our very own. The Lux Radio Theater, Hollywood Boulevard, in the motion picture capital of the world. The curtain rises. Lux presents Hollywood. Tonight, the makers of Lux Toilet Soap bring you Marlena Dietrich, Clark Gable, Cecil B. DeMille, Jesse Lasky, and other great personalities. Miss Dietrich, Mr. Gable, and an all-star cast will present the romantic melodrama, The Legionnaire and the Lady. Our music is under the leadership of Mr. Louis Silvers, who is director of music for the great 20th Century Fox Studios and winner of the Motion Picture Academy Award for Music. Mr. Silvers. And more good news. We give you, as our Hollywood producer, a man who will not only bring you the greatest plays and players, but the very spirit of Hollywood itself. That outstanding figure of the motion picture world, Mr. Cecil B. DeMille.
Greetings from Hollywood, ladies and gentlemen. There are two theaters in this town, almost as famous as Hollywood itself. They are Grauman's Chinese and the Carthy Circle. Perhaps it's a coincidence that a production of mine opened both of these theaters. The King of Kings raised the curtain at the Chinese. The Vulgar Boatman was the first theater ever shown at the Carthy Circle, first picture. And tonight, it is my privilege to open the new Hollywood Theater, whose audience is greater than any four walls could encompass. The largest theater in the world, the Lux Radio Theater. The stars of our production tonight are Marlena Dietrich and Clark Gable, and the play, The Legionnaire and the Lady. Is it possible that the manufacturers of Lux Soap asked me to produce this series of programs because of all the deluxe bathtubs that have been seen in my pictures? They should have a soft spot in their hearts for me. But I think the real reason goes back far beyond the recollection of any of us. When William the Conqueror whipped the Saxons at the Battle of Hastings in 1066, the Blunt DeMille family crest was born. The motto on that crest is Thy Light, My Life, which is, of course, in Latin, and reads Lux Tua Vita Mea. So you see, Lux has been a household word in the DeMille family for 870 years. But producing a program like this is a privilege and an adventure. But truthfully, I'm a little awed at the responsibility. Sitting before me in the Lux Radio Theater is the most distinguished and perhaps the most critical audience ever assembled in Hollywood. I see a lot of familiar faces. There's Joan Blondell, Gary Cooper. He stars in my next picture, The Plainsman. Stuart Irwin and his lovely wife, June Collier. Al Jolson. Ruby Keeler. There's Francho Tone. Ah, and there's our mayor, Frank L. Shaw of Los Angeles. And I think I see Freddie March. I fed him to the lions the last time I directed him. And now we ring up the curtain on the play of the evening, The Legionnaire and the Lady, starring Marlena Dietrich and Clark Gable. Algiers, the land of sun and sand, and yellow dunes that slope down to the sea. In the harbor of Port Nehar, a French steamship rides at anchor. Near the rail, gazing at the sunlit minarets of the tiny town, stands Ami Jolie, an entertainer from the shabby music halls of Europe. Suddenly she turns from the rail and speaks to the ship's steward.
Oh, Stuart.
Oui, mademoiselle.
Are we going to land soon?
In a moment, mademoiselle. There's no pier in Algiers. The passengers must take a motor launch to the shore.
Oh, thank you, Stuart.
May I take care of your suitcase, mademoiselle?
No, I'll carry it myself.
Stuart, may I see you for a moment?
Oh, Monsieur Lavassier, of course. What can I do for you, monsieur?
My valet is in the stateroom with my luggage. Will you go in, please, and make arrangements to have it sent to the hotel?
Of course, monsieur. I will see to it at once.
Oh.
Mademoiselle, your suitcase.
It is very stupid of me. That is the second time I've dropped it.
Here, let me help you pick up your things.
Oh, please don't bother.
Well, it's no bother at all. There you are.
Merci, monsieur. You're very kind.
Why not? Is this your first visit to Algiers?
Yes.
I make the trip quite often. Perhaps I can be of some service.
I think not, monsieur.
I'd be happy to help you.
I won't need any help.
Well, if you do, you can always reach me at the Hotel Dupre. I am Monsieur Labessier.
Merci, monsieur. But now, will you excuse me?
Of course, mademoiselle.
Monsieur Labessier, I have...
Oh, Stuart, come here.
Si.
That woman who was standing here, do you know who she is?
Why, I know, monsieur. A votable actress, probably.
A votable actress? Well, just how do you know that?
We carry them every trip, monsieur. They come to sing and dance in the cafes here. We call them suicide passengers. One-way tickets. They never return.
Well, what launch is she booked for?
I believe the third, monsieur. And you?
Naturally, the third. Assist you, mademoiselle?
Thank you.
Well, be careful. That board they call a gangplank isn't very stable. Ah, there we are.
There seems to be quite a crowd to greet us.
It's the usual thing. The natives here meet every boat. Sell you anything from a fez to a bottle of Arabic perfume.
That fragrance in the air now, that is not perfume.
No, that's just the waterfront of Algiers. Oh, shall we get away from here, mademoiselle?
If you please.
The center of the town is this way. If you would like to take a carriage with me, I should...
No, I'll walk. I haven't far to go.
About your suitcase?
It is very light, monsieur. No trouble at all.
But perhaps I'd better walk with you. The streets aren't very safe down here near the waterfront.
I'll be quite safe, monsieur. And look, there are soldiers to protect me. A whole regiment.
Yes, the Foreign Legion. Mostly criminals themselves, so I've heard. Won't you please ride with me?
Thank you, monsieur, but I prefer to walk by myself.
As you wish, mademoiselle.
Hey! Now listen here, fatheads. We are back home again. And just because you did a little fighting, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking... Well, here comes us, the Foreign Legion. Each man a hero. The whole town's ours, and we're going to rip it wide open. Well, forget it. This time you're going to behave like gentlemen, even if it kills you. Yeah, I'm talking to you, Legionnaire Brown. Legionnaire Tom Brown.
Yes, sir.
Step forward here.
Yes, sir.
Well, did you hear what I just said?
Yes, sir.
What? You weren't listening, were you?
No, sir.
Why not?
Yes, sir. I mean...
Shut up!
Yes, sir.
I want to warn you, Brown. We're not back in the States now. This is Algiers, the Foreign Legion. If you go starting up any trouble among the girls here the way you did the last time, you're going to find yourself in the jug. You get that? Now go on. Get back there in line.
Yes, sir.
And remember what I said to you guys. Take it easy and act like gentlemen. Company dismissed!
Hey, Tom!
Oh, hello, Blimey.
Oh, say, what's eating the sergeant? Blimey, if I didn't think he was going to bite your head off.
Oh, he doesn't worry me. He got away from driving a hack. Say, where are you going tonight?
I don't know. After what the sergeant said about behaving like gentlemen, I don't know where to go.
Ah, forget it. I know a little Spanish girl in this burg who can cook a steak to a turn. What do you say?
Suits me, if we can find a steak. In this here blasted heat, steaks gets cooked right on the cow.
Come on, I'll find one. Say, I know this joint from top to bottom. When I was here and... Hey, Blimey, wait a minute. Blimey, will you look at that?
Aye? What, where?
That girl, carrying the suitcase.
Oh, Blimey, she sure is a looker.
Yeah, she sure is. I wonder what she's doing in this town.
Oh, dance hall girl, I suppose.
Yeah. Well, maybe I better find out.
Yeah, wait, I thought we was going for a meal someplace.
Now, a little later, Blimey. This is pretty important.
Wait, listen, Tom.
So long, Blimey.
All right, go ahead and desert me, lady killer.
clause, is there?
Hello, soldier.
You going my way?
It depends. Which way are you going?
Any way you are. Here, let me carry your suitcase for you.
Don't bother. I'll carry it myself.
Oh, kind of independent, huh? You mind if I walk along with you?
If you want.
Well, that's friendly enough. How about stopping off for a drink? I know a little place.
I'm sorry, monsieur. I have no time now.
Oh, I get it. Okay, sister. If there isn't anything I can do for you.
There is. You can tell me where's the Café Marrakech.
The Café Marrakech? Oh, sure. It's just across the street. Come on, I'll show you.
Thank you, monsieur.
You work there?
I'm a singer. If you are doing nothing tonight, you might come and hear me.
Yeah. Okay. I'll remember that. Well, there you are. It's that door there. Anything else?
Nothing.
Okay. I'll see you tonight.
Entro.
Is this the Café Marrakech?
It is. I am Lotinto, the proprietor.
And I'm Ami Jolie.
Ami Jolie? Oh, yes. Yes, I have your letter here somewhere. You are ready to work tonight?
Of course.
Good. Your dressing room is at the end of the hall. Go there and wait for me. I want to have a talk with you before you go on.
Very well, monsieur. Come in.
Mademoiselle, how she is back. This is a great night for you. If you make a hit, you can stay here as long as you like.
You're very kind, Monsieur Latinto.
Now, mademoiselle, one word of advice. Pick yourself a protector. It will give you prestige. And always choose an officer in the Legion. The private, he is nobody. Pick the officers. They have the money. You understand?
Perfectly.
Good. Are you ready to sing now? I will go out and make the announcement.
In a moment.
Good. Come as soon as you can.
Tommy, but this is a good table. Right up in front among the best.
Shut up. We're not supposed to be here.
Why not?
Not with an adjutant in the house. Old man Cesar, sitting over there. See him?
Blimey, if he ain't the old goat.
If he's seen me here, he's probably complained to Lotinto.
Well, don't he like you, the adjutant?
Like me? Say, he'd stick a bayonet in my back and laugh doing it.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Café Marrakech is honored tonight by the presence of the distinguished painter, Monsieur Labessière, and my old friend, Adjutant César of the Foreign Legion. Tonight, we open the program with Mademoiselle Ami Jolie, a newcomer whom I hope you will receive with your usual discriminating kind.
We treat her very kind. Maybe she comes sit on my lap.
Who's a wise guy?
Gabon, come and see.
Ladies and gentlemen, I take a pleasure in presenting Mademoiselle Ami Jolie.
Here, Mademoiselle! Artiste of Gabon, the best man in the Legion.
Let me go, please.
He's itching for a sock. Now he's going to get it.
Hey, wait, Tom, come back here.
Looking for Gabon, but I insist. Look, Mademoiselle, I'll show you how we make love in the Legion. You will like it.
Stop it, I say. Stop it.
Oh, but Mademoiselle, you are enchanted.
All right, Gabon, take your hands off that girl.
What is that?
You heard me. Leave her alone.
I take no orders from you. Gabon, do what he likes.
And so do I. How do you like that? There's more where that came from, Gabon. Get up and I'll put you away for keeps.
Nice work,
gentlemen,
Tom.
And please, gentlemen, no fighting here. Everyone back to their tables. Francois, throw that Gabon out and keep him out. Everyone, please, back to your tables. Mademoiselle Ami Jolie will sing later. Ami, go to your dressing room. Orchestra, play!
Hey, go ahead, sister. You never can tell what'll happen now.
May I say thank you, monsieur?
Oh, that's all right. I had a good time myself.
Yeah, he coming to me, all right, he did.
Ami, come along.
Excuse me, monsieur. Here, take this.
Hey, Tom, she threw you a flower.
I know it. You think I'm blind?
Say, she's a little bit of all right. I like her.
Your taste is improving.
Well, Monsieur Lotinto, my first appearance was not a success.
Oh, that is nothing. A common occurrence here in Algiers. But I have a news. Adjutant César has already asked for the honor of your company.
Adjutant César, who is he?
Oh, a very important man, high in the Foreign Legion, and one of my best customers.
Tell the adjutant I'll try to oblige him.
Good.
When I find the time.
Oh, and now, mademoiselle,
you must go out there again. Not to sing this time. This time you sell apples. That is the most important thing. You go around the hall from table to table and sell all you can. 10% is yours and 90% is mine. Oh, you will make a fortune.
Give me the basket, monsieur.
Good. Here, go now.
An apple, sir? Who will buy an apple? An apple, sir?
Mademoiselle.
Oh, Monsieur Lavassière.
I didn't anticipate this pleasure so soon. Can I also have an apple?
But I have no change for that.
I hardly expected you would have.
You are again very kind.
Mademoiselle, may I have the honor of your company after the performance?
I'm sorry. I have disposed of the balance of the evening.
Some other time, perhaps.
Of course. You will excuse me now, please. Apple? An apple, sir?
Here, mademoiselle.
Do you wish to buy, sir?
Later, perhaps. I'm Adjutant Caesar.
Oh, yes?
I have already spoken to Lotinto concerning you. Sit down.
I'm sorry, Adjutant.
You mean you refuse to sit with me?
I'm very busy now. Some other time, monsieur.
But some other time won't do, mademoiselle. I would like your company here and now.
Would you? It is a shame, Adjutant, but I must disappoint you. Who'll buy an apple? An apple, sir. An apple.
Here she comes, Tom. She's selling apples.
Good evening, soldier.
Good evening, mademoiselle. Thanks for the flower.
Can I offer you an apple, too?
Yeah, sure. Lend me 20 francs, Blamey.
That makes 60, you owe me. Here you are.
Take it, mademoiselle.
Thank you.
2 weeks' pay is a lot of money for an apple.
You can have it for nothing, if you like.
Oh, no, no, nothing doing. I always pay for what I get. I'd sit down if I were you. Come on.
You needn't pull me down, soldier.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to hurt you.
You're very brave, aren't you?
Oh, I don't know. Why? Do you like brave men?
Perhaps.
Hey, wait. Where are you going?
I'm busy now, but later. I'll be out there, on the balcony.
Okay. I'll see you later. You can smell the desert tonight. Hot, isn't it?
Cooler than inside.
Expect to stay in Algiers very long?
Who knows? They say when a singer comes here to work, she stays forever.
I've seen it work out that way.
I beg your pardon.
Adjutant?
Good evening, mademoiselle.
Good evening, Adjutant César.
I saw you come out this way, and I gathered that you were no longer very busy.
But I am. You see, I invited this gentleman to come out here and sit with me.
Oh, I see. mademoiselle, you are new in Algiers. Perhaps you do not realize that this gentleman, as you call him, is a legionnaire, a private.
I choose my company by their looks, not by their medals.
Am I to take it, then, that you prefer his company to mine?
Take it as you like, monsieur.
Thank you. But I'm still the adjutant here. Legionnaire Brown, you will please leave here at once.
I'm off duty, sir.
I asked you to leave. Did you hear me?
Yes, sir. But the lady has asked me to stay.
May I remind you that I'm your superior officer?
I'm sorry, sir, but I'm going to stay.
Very well. Legionnaire Brown, you will report to headquarters in the morning. Report to me, personally.
Very good, sir.
Good night, mademoiselle.
You shouldn't have done that.
I know it.
You think being here with me is worth the risk?
Sure, if you think so. Play some more.
I think you'd better go now, soldier.
All right, lady. You won't have any trouble getting rid of me.
Nothing like independence, is there?
Well, maybe I am independent. With women.
You evidently don't think much of women.
Well, I'll tell you, lady. It's their fault, not mine.
Been in the Legion very long?
Almost 3 years. 3 years. It seems like 300.
You sound tired of life.
Well, I don't know whether I am or not. I was when I joined this outfit. Well, how about you, mademoiselle? Been on the stage very long?
Long enough.
Tired of it?
No.
Well, what in the name of 10,000 corporals did you come to a country like this for, anyway?
I understand that men are never asked why they enter the Foreign Legion.
That's right. They never asked me. And if they had, I wouldn't have told. When I crashed the Legion, I ditched the past.
There's a Foreign Legion of women, too. But we have no uniforms, no flags, and no medals when we are brave. No wound stripes when we are hurt.
Well, look here. Is there anything I can do to help you?
No. I've heard that before. Or do you think you can restore my faith in men?
Oh, no, 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 not me. You got the wrong man for that. Anybody who has faith in me is a sucker.
You'd better go now. I'm beginning to like you.
You know, I've told women about everything a man can say. But I'm going to tell you something I've never told a woman before. I wish I'd met you 10 years ago. Good night.
Good night, and thank you.
We pause for station identification. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Marlena Dietrich and Clark Gable in the Lux Radio Theater's presentation of The Legionnaire and the Lady continue in just a moment. Meanwhile, we'll give you a glimpse behind the scenes in Hollywood as we take you on a quick tour of the screen capital. First stop in Hollywood, the main casting office of the Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer Studio, a seething mass of men and women seeking jobs. We enter as two hopeful young extra girls are talking in a corner.
I heard they're casting 25 girls for Joan Crawford's new picture, The Gorgeous Hussy. Think we stand a chance?
You bet I do.
What makes you so sure?
Oh, because in this scene, it's your face and shoulders that count. They're casting complexions today.
Mm, that's okay for you, but look at me. I wish my complexion looked as nice as yours. Maybe there is something in the way you take care of it. That business of removing cosmetics thoroughly with Lux toilet soap. I guess I'm just one of those cosmetic skin girls they talk about.
Oh, well, don't worry.
Hey, Joan.
Oh, wait a minute. They're calling to me. What is it?
Okay for you today.
Oh, he'll use me in the scene at the Dutch embassy. Hey, mister, what about my friend?
Can't use her.
Gee, Alice, I'm sorry.
And now, a table for two at the fashionable Trocadero, the supper club that is the rendezvous of the stars.
You look lovely tonight, darling. Perfectly adorable.
Oh, darling, you're just saying that.
No, honest. You've got everything that any of those movie stars dancing there have, and especially that knockout of a complexion.
Well, darling, maybe you should thank those stars for that. Because I take care of my complexion the same way they do.
Well, I don't know about thanking those stars for what you do, but I sure thank my stars for what you are.
Every girl needs a lovely complexion, and the movie stars here in Hollywood have shown you how to keep skin lovely. Don't allow dust and dirt, stale rouge and powder to clog the pores. Before you put on fresh makeup during the day, always before you go to bed at night, use Lux toilet soap. Marlena Dietrich, as Amy Jolie, and Clark Gable as Legionnaire Tom Brown, continue with our play, The Legionnaire and the Lady. It has been several hours since Tom told Amy that he wished he had met her 10 years sooner. At Foreign Legion headquarters, his head reeling from the heat of the tiny office in which he sits, Adjutant Caesar is working at his desk. An orderly enters.
Adjutant.
Yes, what is it?
Legionnaire Brown's here.
Oh, is he? Tell him to come in.
Oui, monsieur. Entrez.
Thanks.
Good morning, Adjutant. You asked me to report to you this morning.
I have not forgotten. Stand over there. Legionnaire Brown, I think it is hardly necessary to remind you that insubordination is a serious offense.
Insubordination? But I was off duty.
Off duty or on duty, the word of a superior officer is law. You refuse to obey. You are therefore guilty of a breach of conduct and subject to court-martial. Report to the sergeant and place yourself under arrest.
Yes, sir.
Of course, there's nothing personal in this. I mean, you're not just sore about last night or anything.
Oh, you forget yourself.
No, I don't. You have no reason to court-martial me except that you wanted that girl to yourself. And I took her out from under your nose.
Silence!
Silence your foot. You don't scare me with a nickel.
Well, a year in prison might.
You ought to know.
What's that?
A year in prison. That's short compared to what you were going to serve before you escaped.
Are you quite sure you know what you're talking about?
I'm talking about a little matter of homicide, murder, in Berlin. The murderer's name was Cesar. He got 30 years, but he escaped. It's a funny thing. He looked just like you, Adjutant. Without the mustache.
Legionnaire Brown, you...
You're a fool.
Sure.
If I wasn't, I wouldn't be in the Foreign Legion, sweating blood for a rat like you.
Entrez.
That woman's here, Adjutant. The one you sent for.
Send her in.
This way, mademoiselle.
Good morning.
Good morning. You wish to see me?
If you don't mind. Hello.
Oh. Are you here, too?
Yeah, sure. You never can tell where you'll run into me.
For the next few days, we'll know exactly where to run into you. Orderly.
Yes, Adjutant?
Take this man to the guardhouse.
The guardhouse? What for?
That's the Legion's business, mademoiselle. And mine. Take him.
Sure. I'm sorry I couldn't stay, mademoiselle. Good morning, Adjutant.
What are you going to do with him?
That is not the question at the moment, mademoiselle. The question is, what are we going to do with you?
I don't understand you, monsieur.
No. It is the policy of the Legion, mademoiselle, not to interfere in the private affairs of any resident. But when the private affairs of the resident intrude upon the performance of a soldier's duty, we find it necessary to take steps.
What steps?
Such as asking the person to leave Algiers. In the future, mademoiselle, will you please act accordingly? That's all.
One moment. Last night was my fault, more than the Legionnaire's. I ask you to be lenient with him.
You were not very lenient with me, mademoiselle.
Please.
There is nothing I can do. Good morning.
Good morning. There's the story, Monsieur Labassiere. You said I should come to you if I needed help. I need it now.
I think the Legionnaire is the one who needs help.
Monsieur Labassiere, what will they do to him?
I don't know. Personally, I shouldn't care to have Adjutant Caesar as an enemy.
I seem to have the unhappy faculty of causing trouble wherever I go.
Oh, nonsense. You know, I carry some weight with Caesar. Possibly I can help you.
Every time a man has helped me, there has been a price. What's yours?
My price? A smile.
I can pay that, monsieur.
Where is the Legionnaire now?
In the guardhouse. I saw him this afternoon. I bribed the guard.
Did you tell him you were coming to me?
No. He says not to worry, that he'll be out before morning.
Well, perhaps he will.
He's in the third cell, Sergeant.
Legionnaire Brown.
Oh, hello, Sergeant. Nice of you to call. Sit down. Make yourself comfortable.
No wisecracks, you. No wisecracks. There's your pass.
Hey, you mean I'm getting out of this joint?
Yeah, the door's wide open and you can do as you like. Until 7 o'clock in the morning.
What's the idea of this?
You're leaving for a month of pass tomorrow.
Oh, no, not me. You know, I'm beginning to like this town. Tell Cesar I'm not going.
Tell him yourself. He's going along this time.
Who's going along?
You heard what I said. Caesar's going.
Oh. Yeah?
Yeah. Now go on. Get out of here.
Yeah, sure. So long, Sarge.
And see if you can stay out of here for once in a while.
I'll do my best.
Tom. Hey, Tom.
Hey, Blimey, come here.
Yeah, I'll be waiting for you. That's the idea.
Yeah? Well, don't talk now. Let's get away from here.
Eh?
Come on. Keep walking.
Oh, what's up? You're out, ain't you?
Yeah, until 7 o'clock tomorrow morning.
Struth. They ain't going to give you a court-martial.
Oh, no, not Mr. Cesar. He got a better idea than that. I think I'm on to it. He's going to get me out on the desert, face me in the right direction, and put a bullet in my back.
Put a bullet in... Oh, the eat's got you.
You think so?
Well, what does Caesar want to plug you for anyway?
My old failing, Blimey. I talked right in his beard and told him what was what. You see, I know something about that bird, and now he knows I know it.
It's truth.
But he's not going to use me for target practice. I'm through with the army, Blimey, washed up. I've been looking for the right kind of woman all my life, and I think I've found her.
Now, listen here. If you're talking about the mademoiselle of the cafe...
That's who, Blimey?
Well, you're crazy. She ain't nothing but a cheap little gold.
Oh, no, she isn't, Blimey. She's all right. And I'm quitting the army and taking her out of here tonight.
You don't say. Anybody hear what the penalty is for desertion?
Say, there's 100 ways of dying, brother, and I'm picking my own.
Come in.
Good evening, mademoiselle.
Monsieur Belavassier, come in.
And how are you this evening?
I'm well, thank you. The flowers you sent are wonderful.
Not half so wonderful as I should wish.
Any news of him?
Some. He's not to be court-martialed, but they are going to transfer him.
Oh. Oh, that means he...
You will have to leave town.
Of course.
I see.
Do you love him?
I don't know. I hope not.
Look, I've brought you something.
Brought me something?
A bracelet. May I put it on you?
I can't accept this, monsieur. It's worth a fortune.
Anything of less value would be unworthy of you.
I'm sorry, monsieur. I cannot take it.
Well, let me leave it here on the dressing table. If you change your mind.
I won't.
Has anyone ever told you that I'm a very wealthy man?
I've heard so.
Does it mean so little to you?
In what way, monsieur?
I'd like to take you away from here.
Would you? Exactly what do you offer now?
The conventional thing? My offer is highly respectable. Marriage.
You're a strange man.
You find it so strange that I should be fond of you?
Must I answer you now?
I'd sleep better tonight if you did. Well?
I don't think I care to take advantage of your tempting offer.
Then you're in love.
No. I don't think I am.
Supposing you'd never met a certain private in the Foreign Legion, what would your answer have been?
It might have been the same. I don't know. Come in.
Hello.
You.
Yes, I'm sorry to bust in like this, but I'm leaving for the Sahara in the morning, and I just came to say goodbye.
Tomorrow? That is short notice, isn't it?
I think you two will want to be alone. I understand you're leaving on a rather strenuous journey. I wish you good luck.
Thanks.
A bientôt, mademoiselle.
A bientôt. Will you be gone long? When will I see you again?
Well, maybe never.
Never?
Yeah. You see, something tells me I'm not coming back this time.
Then you must not go.
You know, that's funny, but that's just what I was thinking. I could desert and board a freighter for Europe tonight.
Why don't you?
I would in a minute, if you'd go with me.
You really want me to?
I really want you to. You know, you've done something to me. I don't know what, but I've been thinking about you every minute since I saw you. Will you come with me?
Yes. I'll go with you. Who is it?
It's I, Lucinto. It's time for you to sell apples. Why are you not outside?
In a moment. Wait here for me. I'll be back.
Oh, excuse me. I thought the hatpatch had gone.
No, no, not yet. I'm waiting here for Mademoiselle Ami to come back.
Well, of course. A wonderful girl, isn't she?
Oh, you've noticed that, too.
Everyone has. And I believe I've fallen a little farther than the rest.
Oh, yes?
Not that it's done me any good.
What do you mean?
She's refused me.
Refused you? You offered to marry her?
Yes, about 10 minutes ago. Here in this room.
Oh, I see. She never mentioned that.
Why should she?
Hey, you're a rich guy, aren't you? Plenty of dough.
So my lawyers tell me. Didn't make much difference with Mademoiselle Ami. She wouldn't even accept a gift from me. That bracelet there on the dressing table. I left it in the hope that she might change her mind, but I'm sure she won't. I'm afraid I'm fighting a lost cause.
You know, that's a laugh, isn't it?
That I should want to marry her?
Oh, no, no, no. I wasn't thinking of that. I was thinking of myself. Legionnaire Tom Brown, 20 bucks a month in keep. Trying to pull the kind uncle act with a girl who could marry a millionaire. You know, I might have known it was too good to be true.
Suppose she's in love with you.
And suppose she's not. What difference does it make? Do you think I'm going to step all over the biggest chance of her life? Oh, no, not me, mister. I may be only a buck private in a tin-sword army, but I know when to take a walk, and I'm taking one now.
Are you sure you're doing the best for her?
Well, it's best for her. Hey, do me a favor, will you? She'll be coming back here in a minute. When she does, let me talk to her alone.
Of course. What are you going to tell her?
Well, I don't know. Yet. But I'll think of something. I'll pick a fight with her. I'll make her sore at me. When I make my exit, she'll probably be glad to see me go.
Well, do as you think best. Good luck.
Was I long?
Yes, a little. I was just leaving.
Leaving? But I'm not ready yet.
I wasn't thinking of you. I'm going alone.
Has anything happened?
Yeah, lots happened. I've changed my mind, sister.
Why?
I'm no sucker, lady. Maybe you thought I was, but I'm not.
Tom, I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, yes, you do. I've been on the level with you, and I thought you were with me. But you shouldn't have left me here alone. I saw too much.
What did you see?
That pretty little diamond bracelet over there on the dressing table.
Well?
A new acquisition, isn't it? Or are you going to tell me you borrowed it from a girlfriend?
It was given to me tonight. I haven't accepted it yet.
Oh, that's a better one. Go ahead, sister. It sounds swell.
You think that
I don't have to think. Girls like you don't wear diamonds. And when they do, well, that doesn't go with me. I'm hard-boiled, but not enough for that stuff. A one-man woman is what I want, or nothing at all. This time, it's nothing at all. So long, sister.
There goes your soldier, mademoiselle.
Yes, he didn't desert after all.
I beg your pardon?
Nothing.
Oh, sorry.
How straight they march when they go out.
Yes, until the heat gets them. It's a bad section they're going to.
I wonder how many of them will come back.
Are you worried about all of them or just one?
What good is it to worry about anything? Those women marching behind the men. Who are they?
The women? I would call them the rear guard.
How can they keep pace with the men?
Well, sometimes they catch up with them and sometimes they don't. Very often when they do, they find their men dead.
Those women must be mad.
Oh, I don't know. You see, they love their men.
Oh, they're even madder than I thought.
All right, but I don't see what good it does. We only have to get up again. Anyhow, those walking bed sheets can't shoot straight.
Oh, no? Well, you'll think different when you get a bullet in your chest.
This heat's enough to mill a guy.
Oh, shut up. If you don't like to swear, why don't you quit?
I was going to, Simon, but you see, I've turned decent.
What?
I said I've turned decent. I'm in love.
You? That's a riot, that is.
Hello, Tom.
Hey, blimey, what the devil are you doing here?
Oh, just come up with a relief. Nearly had me into a bet, Don.
It's that blasted machine gun up there on the hill.
Sergeant! Sergeant!
Yes, sir!
Here comes the adjutant by me. I'm in for something.
Have you spotted that machine gun?
It's up there someplace, sir.
Well, we'll send out a scout. Legionnaire Brown.
I know it.
Legionnaire Brown!
Yes, sir.
Take a man with you and spot that machine gun. If you get close enough, use your hand grenades. It must be destroyed.
Yes, sir.
I'll go with him, sir.
Blimey, are you crazy?
Quiet. You can go with him if you want.
Thank you, sir. It'll be a real pleasure.
Report to me when you get back.
Yeah. When and if we get back. Well, I had the right hunch, didn't I?
That's too bad, Brown.
Yeah. Well?
Hey, wait a minute, you. How about those 10 francs you owe me?
Oh, shut up. Come on, Blimey.
Right behind you, Tom.
So long, fellas.
Go on, you mug. Okay, Blimey. We'll crawl along this trough and slip over the ridge down there.
Right. Oh, maybe they're making it tough for us. Hey, look.
What?
Over there, the adjutant. He's laying in beyond that sand dune.
This is it, Blimey. Here's where I get that bullet in my back.
No, you don't. If he makes a move for his gun, I'll let him have it right between the eyes.
Don't be a fool.
There he goes.
Put the gun down. Put it down.
Let me alone. Let me alone. Come on. Somebody's got it.
Holy.
Hi, what is it?
The adjutant. He's been hit.
Good. Blimey, I hope he croaks. It'll save me the trouble.
Hey, he's got it bad, Blimey.
I hope so.
Hey, come on, let's get going.
Keep low, Tom. They're blasting us hot and heavy.
They must have a spotter. Get over there behind that hill, Blimey. I'll go up this way.
Right into their faces, you man.
Oh, go ahead. I'll be right back.
Come back here, Tom. Come back here. Come back here. Tom. Oh, he's been hit. Tom, where are you?
Here, Blimey. Over here.
Oh, did you get it, Tom?
Yeah. Yeah, I guess I did, Blimey.
Where is it, Tommy boy? Where is it?
In here. It's got to be all tied up in knots.
Tom. Tommy boy.
It's all right, Tommy. Look, you better get back.
And leave you here?
I don't think you can help me much. Funny, isn't it? You were glad Cesar got it. Save you the trouble. Looks like I did the same thing for him.
Tom. Lord, Blimey.
In just a moment, you will hear more of the story of the Legionnaire and the Lady, co-starring Marlena Dietrich and Clark Gable. Do you know what a casting director is? If you want to get into the movies, he's the man you see, or try to see. He knows the names, faces, abilities, and salaries of thousands of players. It is a pleasure to present my friend and associate, who has been casting director at the Paramount Studio for many years, Mr. Fred Datig.
Yes, Mr. DeMille. A casting director has a hard job. Directors are always asking for things like six sets of girls who look like triplets, or a cross-eyed man who can keep his eyes crossed in the same way all through the picture. Last year, a director asked me to get two Tahitian girls who could sing, dance, and play musical instruments. I had to send all the way to Tahiti for them, and when they finally got here, the picture had been called off, but the girls stayed here. Later on, the same director started to make a picture in Tahiti, and we had to send those girls to Tahiti for him. But those are the unusual things. Every day I'm looking for actors and actresses who not only have talent, but who screen well, who have lovely figures, good features, and fine complexions. And Mr. DeMille, I think it's fitting on your Lux Radio Theater to emphasize complexions. Your Lux toilet soap means a lot to both the stars and the extras. They must have good complexions. And that's why Lux toilet soap is the official soap over on the Paramount lot, and in fact, in every other great studio in Hollywood.
We return to the Legionnaire and the Lady with Marlena Dietrich as Amé Jolie and Clark Gable as Legionnaire Tom Brown. Several weeks have gone by, and Amé has received no word from the Legionnaire. Convinced that she will never see him again, she has accepted Le Bissier's offer of marriage. It is the night of their engagement dinner in a room at the Hotel Dupre. Amé Jolie sits by the window, staring into the street. Le Bissier, receiving no answer to his knock, enters.
Amé. Amé, where are you?
Here.
Sitting in the dark. Let me turn the light. That's better. We've all been waiting for you downstairs, Amé.
Have you? I'm sorry. I didn't know.
What have you been doing, darling?
Sitting here by the window, thinking.
About anything in particular, honey?
No, nothing in particular.
You're not at all excited. This is the night of our engagement dinner, or have you forgotten?
How could I forget?
Everybody's here. They're dying to meet you.
I didn't think they would come.
On the contrary, they're delighted to witness the unconditional surrender of the most exacting bachelor in the world. Are you happy, my dear?
Of course. Shall we go down now?
Oh, wait. I want to speak to you.
Anything wrong?
Yes, I have news of your Legionnaire.
What news?
His company returns tonight. That is, what's left of it.
You mean?
I mean that he's not returning with it. He's been wounded. He's in the hospital at the mouth of Paz.
Is he badly hurt?
Oh, I don't know. They wouldn't tell me that.
Then he may be dying. He may be dead by now.
Perhaps.
I've got to go to him.
Amé, are you in love with him?
I've got to see him. Please.
Very well.
You don't mind?
No. You see, I love you, Amé. I'll do anything to make you happy. We'll go together.
Thank you.
Now wait here, and I'll order the car. There it is, I believe.
The hospital?
Yes. You want me to go in with you?
No. It would be best if I went alone.
Very well, my dear.
Good morning, mademoiselle. Something I can do for you?
I'm looking for Legionnaire Tom Brown.
Brown? Hospital case?
Yes.
Let me see. I'm sorry. There's no one by that name on our books.
Are you sure?
Well, he might be under some other name. Have a look.
Thank you.
Hey, Desco Lee, I want to see about that guy that... Well. They break the man of myself in America's Cafe. Hey, don't you remember me? I'm the top sergeant from the 5th Regiment. Say, what are you doing down here anyway?
I'm looking for Legionnaire Tom Brown.
Oh, Brown. Oh, you won't find him here.
He isn't dead.
Dead? Nah, you can't kill that bird. They thought he was a goner when they brought him in, and a couple of days later he was tearing up the bedclothes because they wouldn't give him a drink. They let him out a week ago.
Is he still in town?
Sure he is. He's around the corner at Christine's.
But say, are you going to see him?
Yes.
Well, then tell him not to forget the 10 francs he owes me.
Miss Christine, what kind of a place is it?
It's a cafe. Just poke your head in and look around. When you see a gal with her arms around a guy's shoulder, 10 to 1, that guy will be brown.
Come, Senor Soldier, wake up. Pay a little attention to me.
Oh, go away, will you? Can't you see I'm busy?
Busy? Ah, carving in the top of the table a name. A-M-Y-J-O-L-L-Y. Amy Jolly. That's the girl's name, eh?
Yep.
Who is she?
Well, it wouldn't do you any good if I told you.
You love her very much?
Yep.
Poor boy. She's your sweetheart, no?
Oh, shut up, will you? Go on, beat it.
See, all right, you don't have to get mad at me.
Hello, soldier.
Tommy.
Mind if I sit down?
No. No, of course not.
Thank you.
You gave me a surprise. What are you doing in this part of the world?
I heard you were wounded.
Yeah? Well, I heal fast. Never felt better in my life. Are you married yet?
No.
I heard you were going to marry that rich friend of yours, that Labissiere fellow.
I am.
Are you sure?
I don't change my mind.
I get it. Well, I wish you all the luck in the world, mademoiselle.
Is that all you have to say?
Yeah, that's all. Well, that's me. I guess we're pushing off again.
Where to?
I can't tell, but wherever it is, it'll be thirsty March. I better go and get myself a drink.
You're not going to say goodbye.
We leave at dawn. Come and see us off, will you?
Maybe.
Well, do what you think is best. So long, mademoiselle.
So long, soldier.
Your man, he is gone, senorita?
Yes.
You look sad. Why you don't go with him?
He doesn't want me.
No, he wants no girl. Only one whose name he carved here on the table. See? A-M-Y-J-O-L-L-Y. Amy Jolie.
Amy Jolie? He carved that?
See? He thinks of her all the time.
Well, did you see him?
Yes, he's well again. They're moving him on to fight.
Well, shall we go back?
Not yet. He's leaving at dawn. I'll wait till then.
You want to sit in the car here, Amy, or shall we go back and look for him?
I see him now. His company's not marching yet.
Do you want me to call him over?
Please. He sees us. He's coming this way.
What are you going to say to him?
Just goodbye.
Hello. Out early this morning, mademoiselle.
Yes, we came to see you all.
How do you do, sir?
How do you do?
I'm sorry, I can't stay long. My company's ready to march.
You're going to be out long?
Can't tell.
Hey, lady killer.
Offer, what do you want?
There's a war going on out there. Oh, you're coming or ain't you?
All right, shut up. Well, here we go. Goodbye, mademoiselle.
Goodbye.
Goodbye, sir.
Good luck, Legionnaire Brown.
Thanks.
Well, there he goes.
Out into the sun.
You're going to miss him, aren't you?
I love him.
I knew you did.
He loves me, too.
How do you know?
I always knew.
Army.
The women, the rear guard. They're beginning to follow the men. It hurts me to look at them.
Why?
Because I want to be one of them. I want to follow, too.
You love him that much?
I love him that much. They're almost out in the desert now. I'm going after him.
You're mad. I won't let you go.
Please, you have been so kind to me, but I can't help it. Try to forgive me. Try to understand. I've got to go to him.
Amy!
I must go to him.
Darling, I understand.
Tom.
Amy, what are you doing out here?
I followed you. I will stay with you forever.
Doc, don't be a fool. Go back. Go back before it's too late.
No, I'm going to stay.
But you know what it's like out here. It's torture. Nothing but heat and sand and sun. A burning sun that'll blister your body until you scream.
I don't care. I'm one of the rear guard now. One of the women who love their men.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the story of the Legionnaire and the Lady, as played by Marlena Dietrich and Clark Gable. Before I present our two stars for a curtain call, I'm going to ask an old friend, a pioneer in the motion picture industry, to step up on the stage. We were once partners and made our first film, The Squaw Man, together. It's comfortable to have him at my side tonight as I enter the field of radio. Jesse Lasky of Pickford Lasky Productions.
Well, Cecil, this great new theater on Hollywood Boulevard is quite different from the stable where we started The Squaw Man 23 years ago.
In the middle of an orange grove. In those days, Jesse, there were trees on Hollywood Boulevard instead of neon signs.
A lot of water has run under the bridge since then.
Yeah, speaking of water, do you remember Jacob Stern? You remember we rented the barn from him. Or rather, we rented only half the barn we worked in. Jacob kept his horse in the other half. And every time he washed the buggy, the water ran into our office.
Yes, and we had to put our feet in the wastebasket to keep them from getting wet.
Yes, I put my last dime into that picture of ours.
Yes, and you put my last dime in, too. But it's always stimulating to me, Cecil, to see that in spite of the many changes in Hollywood, the men who started in the picture business with us are now at the top of the heap. You know who I'm thinking of, Adolph Zucker and Samuel Goldwyn, the men who with us founded what is now the great Paramount Company.
Yes, there's one good thing, Jesse, about working on the radio. Somebody else puts up the money. And tonight, in case you haven't heard, it's the manufacturers of Lux soap. You know, it's mighty good soap.
That's one thing that even I will yes you on. Now, Cecil, I want to wish you Godspeed on this series of programs. It's a pleasure to have been here tonight. And I'm glad this excellent radio show will be broadcast from Hollywood from now on.
And now a word about a certain young actor before he steps out on the stage. I want to tell you a little story of him. When I was casting Madame Satan 6 or 7 years ago, I was looking for a villain. Somebody had given my script girl a screen test of a young man, and she kept dinging the life out of me to see it. I asked her if he was a villain, and she said she thought he could do anything. So I looked at it and decided he was not a villain, but that he had definite possibilities. So I showed it to the other executives of the studio. When I asked them about the young man a day or so later, they said he never could succeed in pictures. I asked why not. They said his ears are too big. But evidently those ears were no obstacle to the triumph of Clark Gable. As you stepped out on this stage, Clark, I could hear feminine hearts thumping from coast to coast.
Well, CB, I'm letting that go in one ear and out the other.
If your studio will loan you to my studio, Clark, I'd like to direct you in a picture.
Well, I hear from everybody who has ever worked for you that it's a great experience, if you live through it.
Now, my ears are burning.
No. No, really, though. It was a great show and a lot of fun working for you. And I want to express the gratitude of Miss Dietrich and myself to our all-star supporting cast tonight. Crawford Kent as La Bessière, Frank Riker as Adjutant César, Warwick Kingsford as Blimey, Wally Mayer as the Sergeant, Lou Merrill as Lo Tinto, and Inez Seabury as the Spanish Girl. And thanks also to our fine audience. I want to congratulate Lux on their new theater and on the way they're planning their next week. Two great stars, Mr. William Powell and Miss Myrna Loy, and their famous success, The Thin Man. Good night, Mr. DeMille, and so long, everybody.
And here she comes, as desirable as she was in her picture Desire, as beautiful and glamorous as, well, as only Marlena Dietrich can be.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Mr. DeMille.
We received so many requests, Marlena, that you sing your famous song from The Blue Angel, Falling in Love Again. Will you please?
I'd be very glad to. Mr. Frederick Hollander, the composer of the song, will accompany me. Falling in love again, never.
never wanted to. What am I to do? I can't help it. Love's always been my game. Play it how I may. I was made that way. I can't help it. Men cluster to me like moths around the flame. And if their wings burn, I know I'm not to blame. Falling in love again, never wanted to. What am I to do? I can't help it. Falling in love again, never wanted to. What am I to do? I can't help it. Love's always been my game. Play it how I may. I was made that way. I can't help it. Men cluster to me like moths around a flame. And if their wings burn, I know I'm not to blame. Falling in love again, never wanted to. What am I to do? I can't help it.
Thank you, Miss Deakley. Ladies and gentlemen, this is your announcer, Melville Ruitt. Before Mr. DeMille tells you more about our play for next week, on behalf of our sponsors, the makers of Lux Toilet Soap, I want to express appreciation and gratitude to Mr. DeMille and to the great Hollywood studios who cooperated in making this occasion such a splendid success. From Paramount, Miss Dietrich, who will next be seen on the screen in the David O. Selznick Technicolor production of The Garden of Allah, based on the famous novel by Robert Hitchens. Mr. Clark Gable, the Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer star, came direct to this broadcast from the set of the Warner Cosmopolitan production of Cain and Mabel. He will soon be seen with Jeanette MacDonald in MGM's production San Francisco. Mr. Louis Silvers represents the 20th Century Fox. And to Paramount, our thanks for the loan of our producer, Mr. Cecil B. DeMille, whom I know you are eager to hear. Mr. DeMille.
Next Monday at the same time, we will present that amusing and exciting play, The Thin Man. I am proud to be able to announce that the two great MGM stars who made such a hit on the screen in this remarkable drama, William Powell and Myrna Loy, will play the same roles in the first radio version of it. Next Monday evening, I regret to say, I will not be in Hollywood to produce the Lux Radio Theater play, as I am attending the Paramount Convention in Chicago. In my place, one of Hollywood's distinguished directors, Mr. W.S. Van Dyke, who directed The Thin Man for Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, will be guest producer on this hour. But I'll be back the following Monday, and every Monday, to produce this series of programs for the Lux Radio Theater. On behalf of all who contributed to this evening's performance, our cast, Mr. Louis Silvers and his orchestra, our technical staff and our sponsors, I thank you. And invite you to be guests of the Lux Radio Theater again next Monday night, when this program will be presented from the same station. This is Cecil B. DeMille saying good night to you from Hollywood.
This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
From June 1st, 1936, the Lux Radio Theater presents The Legionnaire and the Lady. You've been listening to When Radio Ruled, podcast number 7, the year 1936. Guest starring, all the way from 1936, were the cast of Fred Allen's Town Hall Tonight, the cast of the Lux Radio Theater production of Is That So?, the cast of Jack Benny's Jell-O program, the cast of the Lux Radio Theater production of Alias Jimmy Valentine, the cast of Major Bowe's Amateur Hour, the 1936 Democratic National Convention, the cast of Eddie Cantor's Texaco Town, the Governor of Kansas, Al Landon, President Franklin D. Roosevelt, Rudy Valley, Ed Wynn, journalist and author John Gunther, Helen Keller, assisted by Polly Thompson, Adolf Hitler, The third game of the 1936 World Series, broadcast by NBC, Cecil B. DeMille, Lou Gehrig, and Carl Hubbell, the cast of Town Hall Meeting of the Air, and the cast of the Maxwell House Burns and Allen Show. Featured songs from 1936 included
"The Music Goes Down and Around, Whoa, 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 When It Comes Out."
"The Music Goes Round," live on Fred Allen's Town Hall Tonight by Gertrude Goldie.
"If they feel like a war on some foreign shore, let them keep it over there. If some fools wanna fight and think might make right, let them keep it over there."
The Dogs of War, Eddie Cantor, live from the New York Hippodrome, November 15, 1936.
"Now let me be your sustain, if you be my bro. Now we can dance together all about the road."
"Let Me Be," Mabel McCoy, live on Fred Allen's Town Hall Tonight.
"Love is like a cigarette. You know you held my heart aglow between your fingertips."
"Love is Like a Cigarette," Harry Hall and his orchestra, live on Your Hit Parade, May 27, 1936.
"It's a bit of trucking. You raise your shoulder and you strut. You dip, you glide, and then you walk a little bit. Talk a little bit. Talk of love and romance.
But if by chance you think of it, then
everybody's doing it rhythmatic.
There is something new in rhythmatic."
Collegiate Rhythm, Rudy Valley, live, February 27, 1936.
"Can anybody tell me who's the greatest new sensation? The fistic marvel of the age, credit to the nation. A boy who won the girlie's heart, the idol of his mama. If you don't know, I'll have you know that it is the Brown Bomber. He's Big Joe Lewis from Alabama."
Joe Lewis, live by Fred Sneed on The Fred Allen Show, June 17, 1936.
"Summertime, and the living is easy."
George Gershwin's Summertime, Billie Holiday, 1936.
"And the cotton is high.
Keep smiling at trouble. For trouble's a bubble, and bubbles will soon go away."
"Keep Smiling," Al Jolson, live on Lux Radio Theater, August 10, 1936.
"You must remember this, a kiss is still a kiss, a sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by."
"As Time Goes By," Rudy Valley, December 31st, 1936.
"On that you can rely."
I'm your host, Mike Gillett. Special thanks to British Pathé Newsreels, Jim Ramsburg, archive.org, otr.net, The Goodies Guy YouTube channel, all the great artists from the golden age of radio, and lots of kindred spirits all over the internet. I'm Mike Gillett, writer and producer. When Radio Ruled is a Before TV production. Copyright 2017.
"A fight for love and glory, a case of do or die. The world will always welcome lovers as time goes by."
Until Saturday then, good night and pleasant smoking. We'll be right back.
You all know the reasons which have impelled me to renounce the throne. But I want you to understand that in making up my mind, I did not forget the country or the empire, which, as Prince of Wales and lately as King, I have for 25 years tried to serve. But you must believe me when I tell you that I have found it impossible to carry the heavy burden of responsibility and to discharge my duties as king as I would wish to do, without the help and support of the woman I love. And I want you to know that the decision I have made has been mine and mine alone. This was a thing I had to judge entirely for myself. The other person most nearly concerned has tried up to the last to persuade me to take a different course. I have made this the most serious decision of my life, only upon the single thought of what would, in the end, be best for all. This decision has been made less difficult to me by the sure knowledge that my brother, with his long training in the public affairs of this country, and with his fine qualities, will be able to take my place forthwith, without interruption or injury to the life and progress of the empire. And he has one matchless blessing, enjoyed by so many of you, and not bestowed on me, a happy home with his wife and children. During these hard days, I have been comforted by Her Majesty, my mother, and by my family. The ministers of the Crown, and in particular Mr. Baldwin, the Prime Minister, have always treated me with full consideration. There has never been any constitutional difference between me and them, and between me and Parliament. Bred in the constitutional tradition by my father, I should never have allowed any such issue to arise. Ever since I was Prince of Wales, and later on, when I occupied the throne, I have been treated with the greatest kindness by all classes of the people, wherever I have lived or journeyed throughout the empire. For that, I am very grateful. I now quit altogether public affairs, and I lay down my burden. It may be some time before I return to my native land, but I shall always follow the fortunes of the British race and empire with profound interest. And if, at any time in the future, I can be found of service to His Majesty in a private station. I shall not fail. And now we all have a new king. I wish him and you, his people, happiness and prosperity with all my heart. God bless you all. God save the king.